Andrew, thanks very much indeed. Welcome to a very noisy Lathwaite Community Stadium for part two of Derby Day here on BBC Radio Surrey. Team news, one change for both teams, starting with the host, Charlie O'Connell, the Peterborough loanee, comes in to make his first start for the club, replacing Dan Moss, who was sent off at the EBB on Boxing Day. So the Woking team in full. Craig Ross is in goal. A back four of captain Josh Casey, Scott Cuthbert, Joe McNerney, and the incoming Charlie O'Connell. The three in midfield, the ever-working Jermaine Anderson, Rowan Ince, and former Aldershot midfielder Jim Kellerman. The three that lead the line, James Daly on the left, Rhys Brown on the right, and Padraig Amond through the middle. There is a change on the bench. Woking can welcome back Kyron Lofthouse, who has missed the last two. He is amongst the substitutes, replacing, of course, the suspended Dan Moss, who misses today completely. Ethan Wadey, the spare goalkeeper, Kyron Lofthouse alongside Tyreek Johnson, Jack Rolls, and Jake Vokins. One change as well for Ross McNeely, for Aldershot Town after the defeat on Boxing Day. In comes Giles Phillips at the back to replace Corey Jordan, who had a Boxing Day to forget, gave away the penalty and scored the winning own goal, if you like. Corey Jordan onto the bench. In comes Giles Phillips. The Aldershot Town team in full. Luca Ashby-Hammond is in goal. We suspect a back three for Aldershot. Archie Davis, Tyler Cordner, and the incoming Giles Phillips. The captain Joe Partington is in midfield with Michael Klass, and so too Frank Vincent. The wing backs, 23 Ryan Glover and 3 Ollie Harfield. The two that lead the line, Justin Amaluza and former Woking striker Ini Efiong, who converted from the spot on Boxing Day a little bit too late for the shots. They were coming back at them. They'll be coming back at the cards here today. It's live from 3 o'clock. Thank you, Andrew, and Happy New Year to you and all listeners at home. 20 minutes to kick off here. Woking against Aldershot Town. It doesn't need much more of an introduction than that, really. Part two of Derby Day. Woking the winners on Boxing Day. Very rare win at the EBB, it must be said, in the 21st century. Bare stats to come this afternoon here live on the radio. And you mentioned the team that are to my right. We have one from Woking, one from Aldershot. We'll start with the host and indeed our regular summariser here on BBC Radio. Sorry, that is indeed Ian Nicholson. Ian, Happy New Year to you.
Happy New Year, Mark. Hello, everyone.
What are we thinking about this one?
I don't quite know at the moment. It's already a pretty fervent atmosphere, and it's still got 20 minutes to go before kickoff. So certainly, you know, I think Woking's result on Boxing Day will have, as they say, got a monkey off the back. It's sort of, you know, so many of those disappointing results. So in some ways that lifts a little bit of pressure, but as we know, football's a funny game. So, you know, Woking will be desperate to do a similar job in front of the home fans. Aldershot will be desperate for it not to be two wins on the trot over Christmas. So I can't wait for the match. I don't know about yourself, but it's just a great atmosphere.
It is a great atmosphere. It's a nervy atmosphere as well, particularly if you're in the red and white shirts of Woking. Just very quickly in with the team news as well. Lots of individual battles on the pitch, all over the pitch indeed. Charlie O'Connell, his first start for Woking today. What big boots he has to fill in Dan Moss.
He does. And I think I've seen Charlie play in a few games. He's on loan from Peterborough. He's a solid young defender. I think it was obviously between him and Kyra Lofthouse. Kyra Lofthouse offers a huge amount going forward, but probably not a natural defender. So I think Darren Sahl's gone safe.
Rob, let's come to you. Rob Worrell is with us here on BBC Radio Surrey, of course, regular Aldershot Town commentator. You watch them every week, Rob, and of course a very rare defeat to Woking on Boxing Day. How can they bounce back here today?
Yeah, it had to happen, of course. At some point. From an Aldershot point of view, it was a shame that it happened at the EBB, but it's an interesting scenario, isn't it? As you say, there was a lot of nervousness amongst the Woking fans up until right at the end, and that was proven to, you know, you could see why, especially the penalty went in, brought Aldershot back in it. But from Aldershot Town's point of view, I think as far as the team and the manager and the fans are concerned, you make sure you get at least some kind of a result today, even if that's maybe like a score draw or something. But the opportunity is still there for Aldershot to come here and do exactly what Woking did to them. And then, you know, it ends up honours even over the festive season. That would still represent an improvement for Woking, of course, wouldn't it? But the interesting thing for me is in how they set up. I'm looking at the warm-ups, and it might be indicating that Aldershot are going to go with a 4-4-2 as well. But we'll keep our eye on that one.
We will. We are nicely poised here in the commentary box here. Andrew, Rob, Ian and myself are raring to go for this one. It's Woking against Aldershot Town. Both the teams warming out in front of us. We've used the words poised already. It is beautifully poised. Can Woking do the double, or will Aldershot Town bite back?
Thank you. One thing we've noticed is the crowd, the fans, I think the biggest crowd at this ground for many a year, 4,600. That's on the back of the board. Both teams coming into the game with 16, 17 points for the last 26 close sides. You know, they're out there, their supporters, and you want to get back in your mouth.
Sorry, Andrew, I just had to step away. Say again. Yep. Yep. That's okay. Yeah, I thought so. That's okay. Yeah, that's okay. No problem. All good.
What did John Katz have to say earlier?
Very rare, though. It's a rare opportunity to do that against the same team. You'll have that opportunity for the next time. Darren's New Year's Day, and you're trying to be well back.
Yeah.
So what do you think of the
That's a really big tell.
So what are you looking for your side in that game?
Just seeing his name, yeah. I worked probably in one sentence, so...
Yeah, I agree. Well, it certainly is building up here, Andrew. The suspense as well between the two teams, this rivalry that has grown in the 21st century, of course, when Aldershot Town came back to football. It really is building, and it's a nervous atmosphere, I must say, particularly for Woking, given their exploits on Monday, a very rare victory at the EBB. I think many Woking fans probably couldn't believe the result, to be honest, particularly when listening into the commentary on Monday with Rob and John, that when they went 2-0 up, Aldershot pulled a goal back with Innie Effiong, of course, the former Woking striker. And I think many Woking fans would have turned the radio off. I don't mean to do a disservice, but I think they thought, oh, here we go again. But no, it wasn't the same story. They tore up the typical script in this fixture and recorded a famous 3 points. And given where they are on the table, it's important that they push on now into 2023. They've got a big game here today. Their biggest of the season, of course, for both clubs. But they're currently fourth in the table with 43 points. Aldershot Town a little bit worse are off in 18th with 26 points, can of course climb up to 29 today. I think they can go as high as 16th in the table, and they will have one eye on what's going on behind them. But this is a massive game, and as you speak to many fans as you come in, of course, that it's not about league position, it's about the rivalry and what the two clubs can bring to the table today. It is 4th against 18th in the league, but that doesn't matter, does it? It's Woking against Aldershot.
And still the link. We have our
It will be happening. Yeah, cool. How long's that? Cool. I can see the Woking players. I think you might have to can it. Yeah, go half time. How long on this? Andrew, thanks very much indeed. Happy New Year, everybody. Step into 2023 with us here on BBC Radio Surrey by joining us for one of the highlights of the football season, one of the true spectacles of Surrey sport on the opening day of the new year. Welcome to the Lathwaite Community Stadium for Woking against Aldershot Town in part two of Derby Day. The card struck first on Boxing Day with a famous win at the EBB, courtesy of a Reece Brown penalty against his old side and a disastrous own goal from Corey Jordan. In the Effiong, the former Woking striker half the deficit close to home from the spot, but it was Darren Seld's cards that played the perfect hand in a 2-1 victory. That, however, only half the story with today's contest looming large. Woking finally tore up and burnt the typical script when it comes to this domestic fixture, ending a run of 10 without a win against their old rivals. It does beckon the question, are the tides finally turning? Traditionally, the Cards have a renowned and particularly recognised record when meeting the Shots of common misery and somewhat horror. A bogey team doesn't really quite cut it when it comes to Aldershot, who are unbeaten here since 2016. The visitors have always shown the true values of passion and real resentment to losing in this matchup. It always comes down to who wants it more, who does it mean more to, and that was certainly demonstrated on this turf 12 months ago when yet another late winner for the away side handed them the 3 points. The teams are just down below us. They'll be entering the field of play right now. Here they come, the two teams, Woking against Aldershot. Team news, starting with the host. Manager Darren Sarr makes one change, the enforced change from Monday. Dan Moss is suspended after two yellow cards made a red. So Charlie O'Connell comes in for his first start on loan from Peterborough. What a big game to come into. Kyron Lofthouse is back amongst the substitutes after missing the last two games. So the team in full, Craig Ross is in goal. A back four of Casey, Cuthbert, McNerney and the incoming O'Connell. Kellerman, Anderson and Inter, the three in midfield. James Daly on the left, Reece Brown on the right and Padraig Amond through the centre. For Aldershot, they make one change as well. Then incoming is Giles Phillips. The American central defender comes in to replace Corey Jordan, who had a horror show on Monday, so he's amongst the substitutes. Their team in full. Ashby Hammond is the goalkeeper. Luca Ashby Hammond, that is. A back three, we possibly believe it might be back to a back four. Nevertheless, it's still Archie Davis, Tyler Cordner and Giles Phillips, the three central defenders. Ryan Glover and Ollie Harfield are the wing-backs. Joe Partington and Michael Klass, the two central midfielders, with Frank Vincent bombing forward to support Ini Efeong and Justin Amaluza. The substitutes for Aldershot Town, Harry Paniatu, Marcel Elba-Fontaine, Corey Jordan, who drops to the bench, Odie Alpha and Ben Schroll. Referee this afternoon is Jason Richardson, his assistants Valentine Anekwe and Jack Fagg. The fourth official is Joel Lamping. Woken in their traditional red and white and gold shirts, their black and gold shorts and their white and gold socks. Aldershot in all yellow with black sleeves, yellow shirts, yellow shorts and yellow socks. So who will prevail in this iconic Boxing Day, New Year's Day doubleheader? We are about to find out. It's Woken against Aldershot Town, Surrey against Hampshire will be underway in the next 5 minutes. But just before kickoff here, a chance to remember Angela Potter, who sadly passed away just before Christmas. We will pause for a minute's silence to remember Angela, who devoted so much of her time to the football club in voluntary work.
There will now be a minute's applause to commemorate the life of Angela Potter, a lovely lady and a much loved partner. The applause will start and finish on the referee's whistle.
A minute's applause there for Angela Potter, who passed away just before Christmas, gave so much of her time to Woken Football Club. Woken Football Club and BBC Surrey, remember Angela Potter. We turn our attentions to the game. The red and white of Woken are set. The huddled 11 of Aldershot Town in yellow. We are perfectly poised here in the commentary box. Myself, Mark Francis, has two voices to his right, one being Ian Nicholson and the other Rob Worrell. We'll start with Ian. Ian, what an occasion, what a contest, and what a crowd this is.
Yeah, I think these matches seem to get bigger year on year, and I can't remember an atmosphere like this. Obviously, Woken played Watford a few years ago, and that was a capacity crowd, and certainly in recent years, I can't remember anything like this, and Watford was more of a joyful occasion, I think, because no one expected a huge turn up for the books, but it was just great to be in the third round of the Cup. This has a lot more going for it. It's a very nervy derby we're looking forward to.
The game is underway. Woken playing from right to left as myself, Ian and Rob look. Aldershot left to right. They're shooting towards the Leslie Gossin stand, the visitors. Woken towards the packed Kingfield Road end. James Daly with his first touch in the game. Marching down the left-hand side, chased by Vincent. It's number eight on number eight. Clipped into the penalty area. Looking for Kahneman. Amond on the turn as Luca Ashby-Hammond sees that out for the first goal kick. Delighted to say we can bring in Rob Worrell as well. Rob, initial thoughts on this one?
Yeah, well, it's all. My main initial thoughts are that Aldershot are playing four at the back. So Davies at right back, Harfield at left back, and Amaluzo is playing on the right side of attack. Glover on the left, and Vincent trying to get up and support Effiong in the middle.
Well, we do have another game on BBC Radio Surrey to keep an eye on. That is Dorking Wanderers, who are in action down at the Silver Lake Stadium. I hear there's been goals already, Chris. So for those listening on FM, DAB, the website, and the BBC Sounds app, and indeed the stream, we will throw out to Dorking Wanderers throughout this afternoon's commentary. But we will continue here live at the Lathwaite. Daly with a very sharp throw, looking for Amond, cleared away straight to the feet of Anderson, dragged it away from Amaluza. Daly's first time ball into the box, looking for Kellerman, doesn't get a touch. In the end, Harfield can drive it away, and they bring it forward now with Vincent over on that far side. Now with Glover. Glover, the wrong side of Rohan Ince. Infield looking for Effiong, snatched off him by Kellerman. Thanks very much indeed, Chris. as Ince gets it away, header by Amond. It's 2-on-2 if Woking can get this right, with Amond now looking for Brown. Brown is there, left footed over the keeper, and off the post and in! 2 minutes played, Woking are in front, it's Reece Brown again! 1-2 with Patrick Amond, cut apart the Aldershot Town defence, and Woking lead by a goal to nil. Ian Nicholson.
Well, it's been a frenetic start to the game, both ends. The speed merchants at both ends, but that was a great break and a lovely ball in. And Reece Brown has been a revelation since he came to Woking, just getting that little chip over the keeper. Very delicate, hit the post and then very slowly went into the goal. Great start for Woking and an electric start to the game.
And sadly, not the start that Aldershot Town would have wanted, Rob.
No, I don't think they penetrated well enough going forward, and Glover's eventual pass into Effiong wasn't good enough. Woking turned over the possession. Little bit of space on the right. Beautifully lifted in ball to the middle, and it was really difficult for Brown. And I must admit, 90% of his effort, I thought, that's just going to roll by the post, but it hit the inside of the post and went in. And it's going Woking way again.
Woking 1, Aldershot Town 0. Reece Brown with the goal. That's now 5 goals in 9 Woking appearances from the Wilston striker, who joined a couple of months ago for good money. He's taking this chance as well. Effiong looking for Amaluza, nearly the wrong side of Casey. But Woking have started the brightest, Ian.
Well, 2 goals at Dorking, 1 goal at Woking, and we're not even 3:05 yet, so it's an electric afternoon in Surrey so far. But no, obviously a very positive start for Woking, you know, getting that first goal and getting the crowd going, but it's a long way to go yet.
Amaluza had time there, falls straight to Joe McNerney, who had a good game at the EBB, finds a good pass to Amon, first time header looking for Brown now, set his sights on goal, low drive, just snatched at the effort, but it did get a touch off an Aldershot Town leg on its way through. Woking have their first corner of the game.
Yeah, great little move there from Woking, and Brown, whose confidence must be sky high at the moment, having, you know, it seems he just scores. Well, he scored at Wealdstone and has done very well since coming here, and good little move there between Armand and Brown. Didn't really catch the shot, but it caught a player going through, so corner to Woking. Charlie O'Connell starting, you know, right back in probably what has been, I imagine, the biggest game of his career so far.
Peterborough Loney. Corner cleared away by Effiong. Josh Casey is inside the centre circle, goes all the way back to Ross. First time clearance, gets it back up the other end of the pitch. Underneath it is corner, but Amond beats him to it. Brown has got plenty of room. 25 yards out from goal, finds Ince. Now with Anderson, former Aldershot Town midfielder. Lofted back towards Ince, just too strong. And Harfield had to take it out for a corner. Could have done with a shout there, Rob.
Yeah, communication sadly missing there. That's just going straight out of play for a goal kick, and instead, I guess Ollie Harfield didn't want to take any chances, but this is playing right into Woking's hands, and unfortunately Aldershot have gone behind 15 times this season. They only equalised on 3 of them. They've never come from behind to win a game this season, so they've got it all to do now.
He's come armed with the statistics. I love it. Corner kick taken short by Casey, finding Reece Brown now. Brown goes back to Casey. Infield ball to find Anderson. First time cross straight to Luca Ashby-Hammond, and Aldershot Town can bring it away. One other score to keep you up to date with, which is now a full-time score in the National League South. Farnborough have beaten Hungerford Town by 2-1. So full-time for Farnborough, 3 points to them. We'll keep you up to date with what's going on between Eastleigh and Dorking. But here at the Lathwaite, it's Woking 1, Aldershot Town 0. And it's Woking who have certainly started the brighter of the two teams, as Daly and Davis were clashing there. Aldershot Town get the free kick, and it's hammered away from right to left. Lovely touch from Glover, but dispossessed by Kellerman. O'Connell looking for Brown, who's come short, snatched away by Vincent. Partington gets his first touch and plays it back to Cordner, now looking for Amaluza, but it's just too strong. And Aldershot Town just need to settle here, Rob.
They do need to settle, but one thing that I've noticed, Mark, and I noticed it on the kickoff, it's a totally different atmosphere in the Woking end to how it usually is in this fixtures. The release of pressure from getting that win at Aldershot on Boxing Day, and then the perfect start as well. And, you know, now they'll feel, having won at the EBB and gone ahead, that they can give that party atmosphere that the players can only feed off. And it's up to the Aldershot Town team and supporters to dig deep and rally.
And I would imagine for Aldershot, it's about really just trying to settle the game a bit. And, you know, even if it's a bit messy, just sort of take the sting out of this first 10 minutes or so and then try and work your way back into it.
Absolutely. What's noticeable early on as well, Ian, the referee Jason Richardson is definitely in that mould of not giving the little soft fouls. We've seen it two or three times already. Yeah. He's not interested in the little nudges, is he?
I think referees this season have been a lot more like...
Oh, Brown's giving it away. Brown could be through. Still needing support with Ince. Sorry to cut you up there, Ian.
No worries. That was out of nowhere, really. An unforced error.
Anderson looking for Ince, and eventually it's cleared away. As Effiong barging over McNerney. Fairly, says the referee, or players allowed to resume. Of course, Woking need no reminder about Ini Effiong. Two spells here at the club, 68 appearances in total, 21 goals, 13 of those last year. Was it a surprise to see him named as an Aldershot Town player in the summer, Ian?
Yes, I mean, you've heard rumours, and I think, to be fair to Ini Effiong, I think he'd been given an offer at Woking that he probably felt he could do better. And I have no qualms, actually, with players. I mean, you know, when they're in a certain point in their career, they're just looking to do the best themselves, do the best for their families, and keep their careers going. It's hard enough to keep your career going anyway without, you know, hanging on just for ideals. So, no, good luck to Ini. He's a nice guy, good family man, and wish him all the best.
Great tackle from O'Connell just a few moments ago, but Aldershot now enjoying possession. We can hopefully grow into the game a little bit more because it's been one-way traffic so far. Glover on to Ini Effiong, Aldershot Town's number nine. Cuthbert challenging. Effiong still has the ball. Out to Phillips. Now finding Davis. Is that 4-4-2 that Rob was referring to? Was it a three or was it a four? Here's Frank Vincent now galloping forward in the centre of the pitch, seeking out support with Glover. Opening up his body, Kellerman comes flying in. Glover still has it. Now with Amaluza, dragging away from Casey, shaping for the shot. Wonderful challenge from McNerney.
But yeah, Aldershot's best moment of the game there. They built up well there, trying to find a little bit of space, and McNerney did well to block the shot.
Partington, his cross was deflected out for a throw. Down to our extreme right-hand side where Mona's corner is. Rob?
Yeah, just it's a good response now from Aldershot. But with that early goal, Aldershot have brought 1,142 fans here, plus whoever's dotted around the crowd as well. And they've just been silenced in the first minute. So, as Ian said, they've got to just take this one on the chin and just forge their way back into the game.
Let's go back to Hampshire. Eastleigh against Dorking. Chris Baldwin. Throw into Aldershot, which Davis will take. There is a player down. It's Jermaine Anderson. Just slightly restricted view from where we are, but he is to his feet. The former Aldershot Town midfielder, of course, who scored a couple of goals in this fixture 12 months ago. So Anderson will be waiting to come back on. So Woking temporarily down to 10. Davis looking for support, has Partington and Amaluza next to him, goes with the latter. Amaluza brings it down to Partington, the Aldershot Town captain. Back to Giles Phillips, the one change for Ross McNeely today. Thank you very much indeed, Chris. Still Woking 1, Aldershot Town 0. McNerney hammers away the loose ball. Amond onto Brown, Ince flying in and locates Kellerman. Kellerman is deflected into the passage of Amond, but Luca Ashby-Hammond, the Aldershot goalkeeper, was on hand. The flag came up anyway, so it will be a free kick to the visitors as Partington is rolling around. I'm not too sure who caught him.
And he's a player, Mark, that Aldershot needs so much. If you look at their stats this season, when he's been in the team, their win percentage is so much higher. He was out for a little while and they sorely missed him. He's a real leader in that team. He's up and he's okay. The referee spotted something he doesn't like, Mark.
A rolling ball.
Yeah.
And perhaps not even taken in the correct place as well. Look at Ashby-Hammond, who's on loan from Fulham. Two clean sheets in his last three. 21 years of age. We see lots of young goalkeepers from the Premier League apply their trade in the fifth tier. So Ashby Hammond will take this. There's been another goal down at the Silver Lake Stadium. Chris Baldwin. McNerney's clearance. Sliced away by Harfield. Had a clear by Cuthbert. It's an Aldershot Town throw. And you just get the feel that Aldershot are growing back into this game. We're going to have sat back since going ahead. 1-2 with Klass. Effiong's header. Anderson is there looking for Brown. It's just too strong for him. Will Brown keep it in play? He can't. Thank you, Chris. 12 minutes played here. Woking 1, Aldershot Town 0. The crowd have just got a bit quieter.
It has gone quieter, and Aldershot have sort of haven't really created much, but they've certainly got themselves back. It's more of an even contest. It was that first 2 or 3 minutes just blew them away a little bit, really. But it's now settled down and should be an intriguing next spell, really, to see who can get the ascendancy.
Harfield with the throw. Down the line looking for Effiong. That's off the back of the head of Kellerman and then Anderson, but free kick goes in Aldershot's favour.
Interesting early on again, much as it was at the EBB, Jim Kellerman a couple of times looking for passes that are going straight into touch. There's so much adrenaline running through his veins. He's a player that plays on the edge anyway. It's a New Year's Day derby against his old club, but he came through in that game on Boxing Day, and he probably was the difference in that second half.
He's been a wonderful signing for Woking this year, signed from Chesterfield in the summer.
Yeah, Jim Kellerman's an interesting one. I mean, off the field, you wouldn't find a sort of more genial, quieter, sort of calm guy. Once he got on the pitch, he describes himself. He said in one of the interviews we did, he said, "Oh, the other team members call me Mr. Angry," but it's as if a switch goes, and he's just highly competitive and is very focused.
And this is a much steelier Woking side anyway, a much better Woking side. But you throw into the mix for this four ex-Aldershot Town players, and it's making the difference.
And here's one of them, Reece Brown. Lovely turn on Phillips, just struggling to get the ball under his spell. Locates Amon now. Is the flag going to come up when Amon touches it? It does. But Reece Brown, who's in arguably the form of his life at the minute, had a spell at Aldershot, as Rob perfectly alluded to on Boxing Day. What a four X shots. Free kick to the visitors. Partington short to Klass. And now out to Tyler Cordner. Harfield, of course, former teammate at Weymouth last season. Klass again. Certainly seen a lot more of the ball now. The Aldershot players. And here's Davis now driving forward down the right-hand side. Locates Vincent. Dispossessed by O'Connell, but gives it straight back to Klass. There's Aldershot players queuing up in the middle of the park. Partington floating a ball out to the Aldershot left. Brought down stylishly by Harfield. Turns away from O'Connell. Infield ball to Vincent. Partington is screaming for it. Here he is, the Aldershot captain. Out to Cordner. Harfield takes a touch. First time ball. McNerney deals with the pressure. Flicked on by Brown. Woking haven't really got too much of midfield at the minute, Ian.
No, it's currently the pressure has been Aldershot pressure, and they've now just won a free kick just in the opposition half. Nothing really malicious, just a bit of a catch, but it's Joe McNerney. We just saw there a typical Joe McNerney clearance header, you know, from his own penalty area, you know, really to the edge of the centre circle, and he's been brilliant since he came in with Lou Wilkinson being injured, and he's been very solid alongside Scott Cuthbert.
So a free kick to be taken by Harfield. Every outfield player inside the Woking half. As the floodlights certainly have brightened up the pitch. Towards the back post, looking for Phillips and indeed Cordner. Neither could get there, but a good chance, Rob.
Yeah, it's another chance. You got two players both just short of it, whereas if one's gone and one stayed, then you got a better chance. Frustrating for Aldershot. Frank Vincent can be a real pain, can be a real nuisance. He can really link the midfield and the forward line, but his little passes have not quite gone right yet so far. Nothing really has gone quite right for Aldershot, and I think Darren Sahl, just a few feet away from us, He's calm, he's assured. He can get excitable too, but he'll be very, very pleased with this start from Woking.
And I think he just wants a bit more at the minute, Ian, because they have cooled off the pressure in the last few minutes.
Yeah, Darren, you talk to him, he's very hard to please.
Phillips' header out for a Woking throw. Even Jake Voken's trying to speed things up there, the substitute. Amond is being told by his captain, Josh Casey, to leave it to me. Casey, not with any red and white shirt, within a 20-metre radius. Here's the run from Brown. Brown back to Casey. Trying to get it under control. Finds Anderson. Anderson, infield pass to find Ince. There's loads of room for Charlie O'Connell, who can bring it out from the centre circle. Takes a touch and floats it towards the Woking left. Amaluza's underneath that. Ince, a free man in midfield. Challenge. Kellerman driving ball. And it was a slice clearance there by Davis. And Amaluza can bring it away for the shots. Rushing aside Anderson, who won the ball, says the referee. The ball is still in play, which Casey wins back. Brown with Daly on his left. Here he is. First time low cross dealt with by Phillips. And it spirals out of play for a Woking throw. We've just reignited the spark in the last few minutes. As I say that, Kellerman lashes a ball out of play.
And Kellerman, Kellerman does what Kellerman does again.
Yeah, really overhit that. But that was good play by Woking. And again, as Rob was saying, I quite like the fact that the referee lets physical challenges go if there's no obvious foul. And we've seen, I think referees generally this season have been doing that. I think there's been a bit of a directive. Saw it in the World Cup as well. For me, it's a good point. It's a good improvement.
The ball goes out for another throw for Woking on halfway. Just a quick point of clarification for anyone who doesn't know. Those 4X shots, Reece Brown, Jim Kellerman, Jermaine Anderson, and the one not so many people know, Josh Casey, who was at Aldershot as a youngster.
12 years ago, Phillips with the header. Speaking of the referee, who is Jason Richardson today, who was in charge for one Woking game earlier on this season. That was the 1-1 draw against Southend. Did hand out 9 yellow cards that day. Most of any game he has matched this season. Daly now bursting forward between all the shot defenders. Was he clipped by Phillips? Yes, just outside the area though. And it will be the first yellow card of the afternoon. And it will go in the direction of Giles Phillips. Ian Nicholson.
Yeah, good to see James Daly getting a good run at the defence there. He's been a bit quiet. He was out injured a little bit and he's been a bit quiet in the last few games. But earlier in the season, obviously, he was scoring a lot of goals and has so much pace to burn, so much energy, both in attack, but also what's often overlooked as a defender as well. He'll track back and so on. So good work by Daly there.
And he went past Partington like he wasn't there. It was so easy, wasn't it?
Like a hot knife through butter. Amond and Casey in charge of the free kick. It's a four-man Aldershot Town wall being marshalled,
or got
constructed rather, by Ashley Amond.
My money's on Amond.
Amond, definitely. It's position A for a right-footed player.
It's got to be. About a yard outside the 18-yard area. McNerney appealing to the referee that the wall isn't far enough back. They're creeping forward. But Amond has his sights set on the ball, around the wall. And I think it was Phillips there to nod it clear, gave away the free kick, dealt with it, but at the expense of a Woking corner. Ian.
Yeah, that would have been a testing free kick if it had gone through, but Aldershot did their work well there. Phillips came in, they'd obviously covered that angle and he cleared it well, but obviously giving away a corner for Charlie O'Connell.
20 minutes played. O'Connell has his second corner to take on this near touchline, being clapped by the Woking fans in that corner of the Kingfield Road end. Referee blows his whistle. Amon had come short. Anderson is poised to run sharply towards him. Brown wants it short and gets it. Brown, oh, lovely turn. Dealt with by Vincent. Woking corner again.
Yeah, they've obviously been working on those short corners to Reece Brown. I think that's two corners we've seen that have gone short to Brown coming forward. I suspect it won't happen this time, but it's referee just having a word there with, as we often see, with Scott Cuthbert and a couple of the Aldershot defenders.
Darren Searle just shouted, Charlie, wrap it. So I think we can see this one a little bit deeper into the box. Indeed it is, punched away by Ashby Hammond at the expense of yet another corner. Darren Searle indicating exactly who he wants to take it, not Casey. He can stay back. O'Connell will switch to the other side. Woking's fifth corner already.
They obviously have a lot of confidence in O'Connell's set pieces. I mean, it's been very noticeable. Josh Casey often takes the corners, but he's back on the halfway line. Jim Kellerman just on the edge of the D.
Everybody and, back for Aldershot. Everybody.
Yeah. O'Connell, oh, it's just too short. Amalusa was there. Amond has picked it up, though. Amond lofted it in to Ince, straight at the goalkeeper. Great opportunity for Woking to double their lead, but Aldershot are away at the other end. Galloping forward is Davis, looking for Effiong. Kellerman is there, and McNerney will see it out for an Aldershot town throw.
Well, great little ball in there, and it was Ince who had a great chance and just really didn't get hold of it. Far too easy for the keeper, and then Aldershot were away, but Woking covered well.
Unusual for Amalusa, who's got really quick feet, but he got that one all wrong, and it's not the place to try it, frankly.
Effiong wins the corner. Let's get a very quick update from Eastleigh Dorking. Chris Baldwin. So corner kick to Aldershot, which will be taken by Archie Davis. Free outfield player inside the Woking half now. Aldershot have got some numbers forward here. Thank you, Chris. You join us at the perfect time again. Aldershot ready to take this corner kick. Halfway inside the first half. Woking still lead by a goal to nil. Daly to the header. Didn't beat the first man, but Davis will get another go. Put away by Ince this time. Amalusa's underneath this. Flicked on. Klass is there. And then Glover. Headed back forward. Now with Klass again. Looking for Amalusa, shaking off and shrugging off the challenge of Kellerman. Amalusa outside of the boot, looking for Tyler Cordner. Amalusa rolls kindly back to Craig Ross. But Amalusa is the one that's causing problems, Rob.
Yeah, he will be, but he needs to be doing it up there where he was then. He's gone down there, half a shout, no pen.
Yeah.
He's been the pick of the Aldershot players this season.
I was just giving you a nudge, Ian. It's okay. Woking throw. Casey. Down the line, looking for Daly. Just clipped on by Glover. Davis will chase. Back to Luca Ashby-Hammond. First time ball out to halffield. Aldershot have played that really well as Amalusa's asking for it short. And here he is. Nice turn away from O'Connell. Referee wants to allow play to go on. Realises Craig Ross is going to get there first. And it will be a Aldershot free kick. And indeed the first yellow card for a Woking player. That's Charlie O'Connell.
Yeah, and Craig Ross gone down there.
Not sure what happened there, Ian. I took my eye off it for a second.
No, I think he came out cleared. I didn't actually see any contact. It's unusual for Craig Ross to go down like that.
So Ethan Wadey will warm up. Sorry, Rob.
It wasn't clear. It really wasn't clear. And I don't think he's just going down just to take the sting out of it, because there's not that much sting in it. Woking are ahead. They're deservedly ahead. They're the ones that have had the majority of the pressure since. Aldershot Town are the 11th top scorers in the National League. They are a different outfit going forward to the last three or four seasons. They've got more goals than them. They just need to just free themselves up a little bit and show that quality going forward.
I guess with goals, of the 31 that Aldershot Town have scored this season, 20 of them have been in the second half. So there's still a long, long way to go in this game. There's a yellow card to Effiong.
Yep. So although the referee pulled it back for the prior foul, he still accepted that the game was in play when Effiong took Ross out.
Yeah, it really wasn't clear. Any Effiong protesting there, I thought it was just a clear clearance by Ross with no contact, but it's right on the other side of the pitch, so it's very hard to see whether there was any contact.
Very quickly on this ref, Jason Richardson, he averages 6 yellow cards a game. He loves a yellow. 3 already in the first half.
He loves a yellow. You love a stat. More to come. Kellerman's header clear. We will run through the other scorelines in the National League in just a moment. We have been hearing Eastleigh 3 up on Dorking on BBC Radio Surrey here. back at the Lathwaite. Woke can still lead by a goal to nil. Free kick and Woke into way. Let's run through the other scores. Bromley 0, Southend United 0, Chesterfield 0, Scunthorpe 1. What a result that could be if they can hold on. Long way to go, of course. Goals between Halifax and Altrincham. Goals between Maidenhead and Wilson. The same scoreline, Oldham and Notts County. And indeed, Yeovil Torquay. So not too many goals away from here. Three at the Silver Lake Stadium. Scunthorpe ahead on Chesterfield and Woking in front on Aldershot. But we are approaching the half-hour mark here. And a long, long way to go in this game. And indeed, the others up and down the grounds. Flicked on by Brown. Straight through to Ashby Hammond. But even with the goal, Ian, I doubt it will cool too many nerves for a Woking perspective.
No, there was probably a moment or so of euphoria for Woking fans, and then suddenly it's, oh dear, there's another 88 minutes to go yet. So it's a derby, it's nervy.
Lovely play from Anderson.
Great work there by Anderson and Daly.
Daly pushed off the ball by Klass. But fairly, says the referee. Darren Zoll couldn't believe the decision. Davis plays it back to Klass, who clears his lines. But Nerney once more underneath this. Brown chests it down. Has support with Ince and Anderson. Goes safely back to Casey. First time thrust of the ball forward. Looking for Amond. But Ashby Hammond is equal to it.
And Amond is immediately running across to cut down the quick throws. He's such a good team player.
He turns 35 in a couple of weeks, Padraig Amond. You wouldn't know it. Plenty of experience in this Woking team. Driving ball forward from Cordner, looking for Effiong, and Ross is there to claim.
No, I mean, Padraig Amond, he's played all but one game where he was substitute this season, and he's had no injury problems. He's just, I from earlier in his career, he might have lost a yard of pace, but he's such a clever footballer.
I'm a loser. Sandwiched between two red and white shirts, was caught there by Ince.
Free definitely kick. A foul. I just think you'll find that Amaluza exaggerated it after the contact, and he's very, he's very adept at doing that. You noticed a couple of minutes ago he gave away a foul, but as he was committing the foul, he was going down himself.
there are a few players like that on both sides, I'm sure.
Yeah. 7 goals this season though for Amaluza. He had 3 years at Maidstone, and spent last year with Motherwell. Began his career with Barnet, so as not always been that far from the National League. Or his trip to Scotland. Here's Parsington, who knows the National League ever so well, doesn't he? Spent a lot of his career down at Eastleigh, where we can get our next update. Eastleigh Dorking, Chris Baldwin. Glover infield to find Klass, who was barged off the ball rather by Brown. Woking give it away cheaply, so Aldershot can restart another attack. Momentum is just starting to shift a little bit. Cordner. On to Harfield, who's got plenty of room to roam down that left-hand side. Casey knows there's the growing presence of Ryan Glover behind him. Here he is. Klass, unmarked on the edge of the area. Will he take the shot? Goes past one. Thank you, Chris. And eventually, Glover, I was going to say, Glover's clearance wasn't the best, but neither was Ince's. And Woking just need to relax here. They need to just accept this wave of momentum from Aldershot. And we talk about the sting in the game. Well, Aldershot cancelled Woking's early out in this game, but Aldershot are growing in confidence as Amond goes down. He's done his running already, to be fair, Padraig Amond, particularly for the first goal. We are going to have a stoppage here, so a chance to get our thoughts on the first half. 30 minutes played, Ian. I think Darren Sowell will just want a bit more ready from his team, because they have sort of, what can I say, sat back a little bit.
Well, they started, as they often do, like an express train, and as hasn't always happened, got a reward for that, and have played pretty well since then. But certainly it's settled down now into being more of an even contest, and Aldershot have built well without particularly threatening. Woking have defended well, and It's an intriguing game. It is an intriguing game, and Woking are going to need to keep this going.
And given all the stats and the record books, Rob, I guess this would probably suit Aldershot at the minute.
If it wasn't for what happened in the third, fourth minute, whatever it was, I'd be quite happy, because the crowd starts. It surprised me, really. I thought that was cue, the party atmosphere for the whole game, but still, those memories live long in the heads of the Woking supporters, and it's tense atmosphere in the ground, isn't it? Aldershot Town don't have a lot to shout about. But if I was Darren Sahl, I'd want a bit more from the Woking crowd. You know, they won at EBB, they're 1-0 up. And yeah, but Aldershot are going to be... They're going to have to be really clinical with their chances when they do create them, because they're not creating much in the way of clear-cut stuff.
Yeah, it really is a wretched record that Woking do have against Aldershot. Just their third win in the 21st century at the EBB. A reminder really of how desperate it's been. But funnily enough, it's actually better form than they've shown here. Just two wins at home, 10 years between them. The most recent back in 2016, where Reece Brown actually scored the goal for Aldershot. Johnny Goddard and Joe Quigley with the goals for Woking. 27 league meetings between the two. Woking with just 5 wins. You can add an extra if you include the FA Cup from a couple of years ago. 18 Aldershot wins. 11 of those are here. It just goes to show Aldershot have always been favoured, no matter what the league table says, when it comes to Woking Aldershot.
No, that's correct. And I think Woking, in fact, someone has compared this Woking side, probably the John Goddard, Scott Randall type team, was probably the closest that Woking have had to this team in recent years, and it's no coincidence, I think, that won two of those, three out of the four in two seasons. But since then, it's been a catalogue of despair, and also often it's been the way it's lost. It's either been a very big defeat or a last minute goal, and I think that's probably why, as Rob says, the Woking fans have got nervous because of that memory. But it's memories can change, but it has to be worked hard to do that.
Absolutely. Class infield ball to find Partington. Nice triangle football from the visitors. Davies now finding Vincent, shouldered onto Glover, low ball, looking for Amaluza, got the ball a little bit stuck, gets the strike away, and it's high and wide. It is the closest Aldershot Town have come, and just a reminder that Amaluza can cause the problems in the Woking defence.
Yeah, best chance Aldershot have had. Amaluza did well. As Rob was saying, they need to be clinical with those chances, and he did well, but it was clearly over. But it's he's been certainly the danger man, much more so at the moment than any Effion would have been, who's been running the channels.
Wasn't his best finish of the season, but the fact that Aldershot have finally got an effort at the goal won't do anything to help the nerves of those Woking fans. But
the Cards have a throw, just over 10 minutes to go until half time. Casey, just a couple of yards away from his manager, Darren Searle, manager and captain, on the same wavelength, down the line, looking for Amond, headed clear, class, straight to Kellerman, who has Ince on the overlap, locates Reece Brown instead, went for the Treston strike, and Ashby Hammond was a little bit awkward for him, will get away with it with the goal kick and a bit of afters with the crowd as well. Just had to be aware of where his net actually was. But he was eventually
called. That's a sign of a player in true form, isn't it, Reece Brown? To
even
try that, something outrageous. He's just plucking the ball out of the sky, and within a nanosecond, he's trying to volley at goal.
Casey, don't see too often a right-footed clearance. And here's Daly, number 8 on number 8 again. Vincent chasing back and doubling up with Davies, but Daly still goes. Who did that last touch come off? It will be a foul against Daly for pulling back Davies.
Spot on.
Former Brighton youth player. Just overran it a little bit, really, Rob, didn't he?
He did. But what a sight James Daly is going forward. I noticed his goal scoring record earlier in the season. But seeing him in the flesh, Boxing Day and again now, what talent he is at this level. Just so direct. He's the most direct forward or wide forward I've seen in so long.
He's found a real new lease of life here at the Lathwaite. 6 goals to his name. The goals have called off. That's not to say that's his fault. Reece Brown, Gregor Cox have been supplying them mostly. Harfield's deflected cross goes straight into the hands of Craig Ross. And Darren Sahl already pointed to exactly where he wants it, as Daly, Amond and Brown are already on the charge. It's 3-on-3. Two Aldershot players going for the same ball. Brown to the second is beaten to it by Klass. Hammered away by Cordner. Ricochets off the back of Kellerman. Anderson is there. And Partington does well to find Vincent. Slice clearance from Klass, as Casey was caught there by Glover, and it will be a free kick to Woking just inside their own half.
Clever from Casey. He felt Glover coming. Glover's not a physical player. He just pushed his body into him, but Casey made sure that maximised the effect of that, and the referee has bought it and given the foul. such a difficult job for referees. I'm not talking I'm talking general, not about either Aldershot or Woking, but at this level, National League, there's so much kidology going on. How do you decide what is, what isn't, what's been exaggerated? You know, the players are getting, unfortunately, ever better at it as well.
I know. Although, I have to say, this season, Josh Casey has done, you know, we became very used to. He was very good at winning those free kicks in the channels, in the corners, as soon as he felt anything on him. He hasn't done that so much this year.
Anderson looking for Daly, who's onside, dealt with by Phillips. Anderson arriving to the scene. Good ball back to Casey. Outside of the boot to Daly, wants the ball back, but Glover is there, and it's a wayward clearance that results in another Woking throw. A couple of other goals that have just gone in. Chesterfield have equalised against Scunthorpe, 1-1 there, and also Halifax Town 0, Altrincham 1. Casey crossed into the area. Ooh. Kellerman was arriving. He threw himself at it, and it's rolling out of play comfortably for a goal kick, which they take quickly, Aldershot. And Amalusa wasn't really anticipating it, although he is there. It's bounced off the back of Ross Amalusa. It's a bit awkward for him, needs a bit of support as Ross rushes back to his goal. Here's Inie Fjong turning back onto his right boots, looking for Klass on the edge of the penalty area. Klass looking to go right to Glover. It gets there in the end, but Woking are getting numbers back now. Glover, low ball straight into Craig Ross. Vincent arriving just too late. Rob Worrell.
It was a good ball actually from Glover. It's gone through to the keeper, but any forward taking a gamble on that has a tap in. From Effiong and from Klass, you see opportunities where see the sights and go for it, but there's one more pass, and that is frustrating to watch right now.
And what a very quick attack that was, Ian, from Aldershot, from goalkeeper to goalkeeper in a matter of 10 seconds.
Yeah, it was. They're very quick, Aldershot. Once the keeper's got the ball, it's a long ball forward to the pace up front, with particularly Amalusa. He's the out man, and got a ricochet there, and it could have gone anywhere.
Daly onto Brown, who has seen so much of the ball in the first 38 minutes. You listen to BBC Radio Surrey here of Woking against Aldershot Town on FM, DAB, BBC Sport website and the BBC Sounds app. As Aldershot are in trouble here, it's Archie Davies who goes into the book, the third Aldershot Town player to receive a yellow card. Daly is still to the ground.
And immediately, Darren Sahl sends a couple of the substitutes down to warm up and also be down close to where Daly is, close to where the referee is, hoping he'll recover there. I suspect it was more a psychological thing than knowing that Daly was injured.
But a free kick nevertheless, which Casey will take.
Another little tick in the box, isn't it, for Daly? He's now got his fullback into the yellow card. And Davies doesn't get too many. He's normally, when he makes his mind up to go in like that, he normally makes the contact with the ball. But he didn't on that occasion. He can have no complaints. And I think the two right-backs, Davies for Aldershot and O'Connell for Woking, need to be very, very careful in this game now. Got a long way to go on yellow cards. And they're up against tricky wingers. Who can very easily draw that unwanted foul.
So Woking with this free kick, probably about 6-7 yards away from the corner flag, which Casey will take. It is an outswinger towards the back post where Ince is arriving, wins the header, dealt with by Cordner, only temporarily though, because McNerney's there. Anderson back to O'Connell. It's on the halfway line again with Kellerman. Daly, first time ball back to Casey. Kellerman once more, and it's gone from a Woking free kick all the way back to Craig Ross, who can clear the Woking lines and go down the right passage now, and cleaned up by Partington and away by Cordner. Here's Amalusa now on the turn. Lovely ball down through the lines to Inie Fjong, who's driving forward now up against Charlie O'Connell. Switches back to his right boot. Fjong still going and equalises. Inie Fjong, he just had to score. Scorer on Boxing Day, scorer on New Year's Day, and Inie Fjong has equalised for Aldershot Town against his former side. 5 minutes to go until half-time, Woking 1, Aldershot Town 1. Rob Worrell.
When he picked the ball up into the left-hand side of the penalty area, I thought, drag it back now, try and make room for a shot. Quite often when he does that, it's a bit slow, it's a bit cumbersome, but he judged it perfectly. He drilled his shot low. And the shots, having quietened the crowd and stayed in the game, have got themselves level 4 minutes before half-time. and it's game on.
It is game on. We'll get the thoughts of Ian Nicholson in just a second, because we've got to go back to the Silver Lake Stadium and Chris Baldwin. So it's level here at the Lathwaite. 1-1, and he just had to score in the Effiong. 21 goals in a Woking shirt. It's now 8 for the season for Aldershot's number 9. And as Rob said, they are level. Great work from Amalusa. And found Effiong. Thanks very much indeed, Chris. Settling our nerves here as there is a yellow flare on the pitch, which Partington's run over to deal with. There's a steward there and indeed the referee. Ian, what can we say? Great work from Amalusa and Ini Effiong. That's what he can do well. Barge his way into the 18-yard area. Low shot, caught out. Craig Ross at the near post.
Yeah, Ini Effiong is best there, really. I think Woking fans will know that on his day, he can be pretty much unplayable. I've heard that phrase used by him about much higher opposition in league opposition in the Cup. And I thought he did really, really well there. And, you know, it's really set this game up just before half-time. And it's going to be important for Woking now for the players to really dig deep and begin to re-establish that sense of supremacy they had earlier on in the game. But fair play to Aldershot. They've done very well. They've really fought their way back into the game. On the break, they've looked dangerous with pace up front and... But that has really been the first real attack of the half that's been dangerous. And but great play by Effiong.
Just to say, there was a yellow flare that went off. I didn't see. Obviously, it's yellow, which today will be the away team Aldershot landing somewhere on the pitch, somewhere between the two sets of fans. Let's move on.
1-1 here at the Lathwaite. Game on. Throw into Woking, who are just re-injecting a bit of pace here in the closing stages to the first half. As I say that, Darren Siles just saying, calm down, relax, let's get to half-time level. Reece Brown, though, from the resulting throw, finds Ince. Back to Casey. Casey, curling ball, looking for Amon, just too strong for him. Arriving is Kellerman, but Harfield was there too first. Amalusa to Harfield. Woking need to hold out to half-time here as O'Connell is rushing back. Here's the goal scorer, Effiong. Delightful ball to find Amalusa. Back to Effiong. Yellow shirts creeping into the penalty area. Effiong now doubled up with O'Connell and Anderson. It's a lofted ball towards the back post. Just too strong for Glover, although he will retrieve it. Glover still there. Support with Davis and indeed Klass. Partington chipping it forward, looking for Vincent. It's just going to spin kindly in the direction of Craig Ross. 60 seconds of the 45 to go. As Darren Sowell has a quick chat with Corin Lofthouse. Will we see him in the second half, because O'Connell is just struggling at right back, Ian?
Well, yes, he has been. I think, you know, most of the Aldershot attacks have been down that right wing, and it's interesting, you know, without Moss there, it's a big change to what has been a very good working defence most of the season.
Yeah, it's been pretty stable as well. Of course, Wilkinson, the most notable absentee, but Nerney and Cuthbert have forged together a good partnership in recent weeks. Bags of experience, 67 the combined age of the two. And Casey has another opportunity with this throw. Locates Anderson in a bit of space, feeds it back to Casey. Now with Brown, who's onside. Brown turning away from Davis. Brown still going. Can he get the strike on goal? Just wide and high, rather. A bit of both. But again, as Rob mentioned a few moments ago, a man with plenty of confidence at the minute, shaping for the shot. We've got 6 minutes to be added on to the first 45. But Reece Brown, for Woking, Ian, they just need to get him on the ball as much as possible.
Yeah, he's got great touch. He makes space for himself, did that there, and caught it well, but probably a foot or two over the bar. But it's first bit of danger Woking have had, really, for quite a while, though.
Effiong, the wrong side of Cuthbert. O'Connell hammers it away straight to the feet of Klass. Bounces off the elbow of Anderson. I don't think he meant it, but free kick anyway. It's a lively end to this first half. 6 minutes added on. Partington to take this free kick just on the centre circle. Ball shot playing left to right as we look. Partington leaves it for Klass. Over the head of Kellerman and Cordner, who's got forward and keeps it in play. will be a woken throat.
Yeah, a few question marks over that 6 minutes, and I am thinking back. I mean, there's been a couple of players going down, but not for any extended period of time.
Two or three minutes.
Would have been standard there, I think. It's an odd one, isn't it? But yeah, maybe he watched a lot of the World Cup, the ref.
I think after the fourth game at the World Cup, we almost had an extra game with the amount of minutes that were added on. Floating ball looking for Effiong, picked up by Vincent. McNerney threw a leg at it. Now with Klass and Davis, Aldershot finding pockets of space all over the pitch. No. Couplet's there to meet the header, but look at the room for Partington, 30 yards out, challenged by Int. Now finds Effiong, who stays onside. A bit of trickery to take it around two, but in the end, just a bit outnumbered. And Woking can fire it clear. It's all Aldershot Town at the minute, Ian.
Yeah, and Effiong looks as though he's just woken up, really. It's the last, since he scored his goal, the last 5 or 10 minutes, he's got an extra spring in his step. he is a confidence player, I think, in Effiong. When he's in the zone, he can do really well. When he's not, it's as if, is he even on the pitch? And it's, you know, I'm sure every club he's played for has seen the same, but it's he's certainly showing signs of being in the zone at the moment.
Anderson finds Brown. Brown just caught in possession there, and Klass could be away. The yellow shirts are firing forward. Klass in the middle. Cuthbert McNerney's there to clear away for Woking at the last moment possible. And Int, the flag came up.
Oh, come on,
but Woking were away at the other end with Amond and Kellerman.
The flag had been up a long while. The ref hadn't noticed it. And when he did notice it, he gave it. And it was unfortunate timing for Woking. Poor ball in the end from Michael Klass. Really well won by Klass, but he had runners either side, and Effiong and Vincent. And a little bit more composure on the ball there. Better time to pass, and Aldershot could have found things even better for them going into the break.
Ross's clearance. Glover's header. McNerney's underneath this one. And then Amond looking for Brown, challenged by Phillips. Brown onto Amond. There's an Aldershot defender there in the way.
Good work again by Brown, who, for the sake of equality or fairness, we have to say it was him losing the ball in midfield that really opened up Woking to that recent attack from Aldershot. He just lingered on the ball too much and was dispossessed. But going forward, another good moment there, which didn't quite come off.
Casey looking for Daly, right next to the corner flag. Infield ball looking for Anderson, who's there, right-footed cross to Casey. Poor touch from Brown, nearly set yellow shirts away once again. Davis up in the air, Cuthbert arrives. Up goes Kellerman, who wins the header just over Ince, who completely mistimed the jump. And Partington spreads it on to Harfield, who unlocks Amalusa down the left side. Amalusa up against O'Connell. O'Connell stood firm this time, and he's done well, the youngster. Needs a bit of support, was just clipped there by the Aldershot Town number 7. And Woking have a free kick.
He did do well. I think he's the most likely of all the players on the yellow card to get a second one today, based on what I've seen only this afternoon. He's full on, 100%. He's playing his heart out for the team, O'Connell. But at some point, he could just get tricked into a clumsy foul. Because what a lot of younger players are like, they're so desperate to win the ball back, where sometimes you just have to jockey and shepherd somebody out.
Yeah, and stick to the basics. We've got around 60 seconds left of injury time, the 6 minutes that were added on. I think the referee is just glaring at his watch, just to let everybody know what's happening. Clearance by Klass. Up goes Ince on Partington. And one or two Aldershot midfielders just let it go for each other. Eventually they hammer it away. Now Effiong's on the charge here. Craig Ross is going to have to come out and deal with the situation. That he does, as Daly lets it run for an Aldershot Town throw. Referee has another look at the watch. But he's not ready to close the first half just yet. Davis seeking a bit of support. Phillips and Corner shouting time to their right back. Down the line it goes, looking for Effiong. McNerney didn't deal with it too well. Effiong couldn't keep it in play. Flag goes up for a Woking throw. What does Darren Sowell need to say at half-time for his Woking team, Ian?
Well, I think Woking played quite well in the half, but I think they just haven't really been able to get a purchase on the game. And I think a lot then falls on the heads of the more experienced players to make their experience count. Get the ball to Brown, who's on the ball now.
Free kick, and this might be Woking's last chance of the half. If it stays 1-1 at the break, Rob, I guess this would certainly, as I say, suit Aldershot Town.
Yeah, certainly would do from the way the game started. Obviously, they've now got some more defending to do. Aldershot are really struggling to cope with Rhys Brown. I think one of the main reasons that I can see after watching Woking for a game and a half why they're up where they are, because I think in Daly and in Anderson, in Amond and in Rhys Brown, they've got four players who either have, can or will play at a higher level.
Yeah. Well, the shame for Anderson is that he probably should be playing at a higher level, but for multiple knee injuries for his time at Peterborough.
Yeah.
He had so many. And he was touted as a very good player in League One. I think began at Arsenal a long time ago. So Casey's resulting free kick is cleared away by Effiong, only to the head of Int. Effiong's wrestling with McNerney now. Arriving is Kellerman. Hasn't cleared it, though. Kellerman, was he caught? Penalty! Kellerman was caught just a yard inside the penalty area. Not too sure who by. There was a real cloud of players in the way. But Woking on the brink of half-time have a chance to go back in front from the spot. And you can guess who has grabbed the ball straight away. Rhys Brown, who converted from the spot on Boxing Day, has another chance to beat Luca Ashby-Hammond on the brink of half-time. Ian Nicholson.
Well, I think it was a melee of players really there, and it, our view's restricted, but Kellerman went down, appeals, and all you can say is there weren't many complaints from Aldershot players. It was he was caught, obviously, and here we go with Rhys Brown.
Rhys Brown up against Ashby Hammond. Rhys Brown sends him the wrong way! Woking are back in front on the edge of half-time. They've been lacking that killing edge ever since Aldershot equalised. They restore their lead. It's 2-1. Rhys Brown once again amongst the goals. 2 for him today. 2 for Woking. They lead by 2-1.
Superbly taken penalty. I have to say, if this is the score going into half-time, it probably is a little bit harsh on Aldershot.
Yeah.
Because I think a draw would have been perfectly set up. But having said that, from the Woking side, it's very pleased. They've shown a lot of resilience. And out of nowhere, really got an opportunity to get the second goal. So going in 2-1 will make the half-time team talk very, very different. But I'm sure the half-time team talk for Aldershot will be do what you've been doing for the last 40 minutes. And for Woking, it'll be you have to dig deep. This is Novi yet.
And Ian's taking the words out of my mouth, Rob, really. It's harsh on Aldershot.
Not really for me. They had two golden opportunities just to put their foot through that and clear it. And when the ball was still in the penalty area and Kellerman thought, well, I'm going to get myself right in where it matters, somebody, by the looks of it, nibbled away, caught him. And Aldershot, who've got themselves back into the game, have shot themselves in the foot and woke him back in the front.
They're the thoughts of Rob Worrell and Ian Nicholson. The half-time whistle has gone here at the Lathwaite Community Stadium. We've not been lacking goals or drama. The last four games have seen both teams score. They both have, but Woking have edged themselves back in front. Scorer, Rhys Brown, after just 2 minutes, put the cards in front. Aldershot grew back into the game as Woking were struggling to manhandle their midfield. Ini Effiong, 5 minutes from the break, restored Aldershot Town's faith in this game, if you like. They grew back into it. They got themselves level. But Rhys Brown has punished them once again from the spot on the brink of half-time. Woking lead at the break in Derby Day Part 2. It's Woking 2, Aldershot Town 1.
Outside the box and angle in the shot into the bottom right hand corner.
Brought down. Effio. Yep. Sorry. Of course. Yeah, it's fairly generic. I'm pretty sure you can. Yeah, well, I think the last question was a prediction, so you need to shave that off.
Oh.
Okay. Yeah, that one. Hold on. Yeah, senior, Rob. Senior. Aldershot out for the second half. And Woking out for the second half as well. Yeah. Andrew, thank you. Welcome back to the Laithwaite Community Stadium for Derby Day Part 2. Part 2 of the game, of course. Second half coming up live. Doesn't appear to be any changes at the break as Aldershot Town return to their pre-match huddle at the start of the second half as Woking are already ready to go. So no changes. Woking continue with Craig Ross in goal. A back four of Casey, Cuthbert, McNerney and Charlie O'Connell. Rowan Ince, Jermaine Anderson and Jim Kellerman, the three in midfield. Padraigamon through the centre. James Deli on the left. And two goal, Reese Brown to the right. Aldershot also unchanged from half-time. Continue with Luca Ashby-Hammond in goal. A back four of Archie Davis, Tyler Cordner, Giles Phillips and Ollie Harfield. In midfield, we have Joe Partington and Michael Klass. On the flanks, Ryan Glover and also Justin Amaluza. Frank Vincent supporting Ini Efiong. So 4-4-2, plays 4-4-2. Woking, or Aldershot rather, who did the double over Woking in the 2021 and 20 season, the 17-18 season and the 16-17 season. Woking's last and only ever double over Aldershot Town was in the 2015-2016 season. They lead here by 2-1 in what will be a long 45 minutes for the hosts. Efiong beyond O'Connell, and Amond will keep this in play. Slip by an Aldershot Town defender, gets back to his feet quickly, offloading to Kellerman. Lovely couple of step overs as well. Kellerman lets fly a shot, and the less said about that, the better. Ian Nicholson.
Yeah, good positive start from Woking. Started with a lot of pace and energy. Possibly had a bit of a rocket at half-time to sort of pick up the pace, because that is what their game is all about. And in the end, Kellerman's effort was pretty lame, but it was good build-up from Woking.
No changes at the break for Aldershot. Rob, is that a surprise?
No, I didn't think they would. I think, and this is really frustrating for me to say, but I think they've probably just shaded that first half and they went in 2-1 down, and that is unfortunately so very Aldershot.
Amond nearly set a light down the line, but the ball was just too strong as Darren Sahl was put on the winter jacket. It certainly dropped in temperature here at the start of the second half, Rob.
I haven't got the stats for you. You'll be relieved to hear on
go
this
on.
Occasion. But Aldershot's ability to concede a goal within 5 to 10 minutes of scoring one is incredible. You wouldn't believe it. I don't have the numbers in front of me, but they've done it
but we get
so
the idea,
many
yeah.
times.
Yeah, we get the gist of it. Particularly ironic that the player that brought them level eventually gave away the penalty. It was Ini Efiong who caught Jim Kellerman. Kellerman went down and Reese Brown converted in Reese Brown style. McNerney's got a bit of a job on here because Amaluza is hunting down Craig Ross. Doesn't take any chances with the first time left-footed clearance. Passes off the back of Partington to Vincent. And nearly actually fed through Reese Brown. It's a poor touch from Klass. Dispossessed though in midfield by Ince as Amond looking for Brown. Is twisting and turning on the wrong side of Phillips, who was on a yellow, went flying into him. Won the ball though. And Aldershot Town have a free kick, which they want to take quickly, and indeed do.
Took it from the wrong place, but the referee let it go.
Harfield on to the empowering presence of Ini Efiong, but nipped off in though by Kellerman. And O'Connell looking for Amond. Harfield stuck a leg out at it. And corner can clean up and spreads the play out to the right side, of which Glover will not give this up and keep this in play. It's an ambitious ball into the box. No yellow shirts there. Amaluza on the edge of the penalty area. Left-footed curling effort is beyond the goal, and indeed Craig Ross, and will be a goal kick in this breaking play. Let's head back down to Hampshire and join Chris Baldwin for Eastleigh Dorking. So 3 minutes played at the start of the second half. King 2, Aldershot Town 1. Goal kick to be taken by Craig Ross, the ever-present goalkeeper for Woking. Ethan Wadey still amongst the substitutes. Yet to get his chance under Darren Sahl, who is standing parallel to Ian Dyer, his assistant. Cleared away by Klass, flicked on by Amaluza. Kellerman. Thank you very much indeed, Chris. Kellerman carving through the Aldershot Town defence just behind Brown. Cleared away eventually by a yellow shirt, and they're away with Glover now. Amaluza and Effiong, the options. Effiong, was he fed through onside? Doesn't matter anyway, because O'Connell was there. It's a poor touch from Daly, which gives it straight back to Amaluza. Two red and white shirts in front of him, though, but Amaluza will go himself, fires a ball across the face of goal, and it will go out in the end for a throw. Woking wanted a flag that didn't come, but they were guilty of giving the ball away at least twice there, Ian.
Yeah, Charlie O'Connell did very well there in cutting out the attack and playing it forward, but then James Daly really just very slackly gave it away, and suddenly Woking are under pressure again. And they really need to, you know, calm it a little bit and sort of really make sure they can keep control of this game.
It's going to go out for another throw, which will go in Aldershot's direction. I think the linesman had the flag up the wrong way there. There's Harfield. Has to glide it forward, and McNerney deals with the pressure. Official attendance handed in, 5,297. So me and Ian, a couple of 100 out. And Rob spot on with the away attendance. Of course, a sold-out Aldershot Town End with 1,142. The official attendance, 5,297. Great turnout, Ian, on New Year's Day.
Terrific, yeah, a really terrific turnout. And it's, I think as Rob was saying earlier, it started with an electric atmosphere, but now both sets, you know, obviously Aldershot behind, so a little bit quiet. Woking probably nervous and a little bit quiet. So it's, I'm sure, you know, as the game goes on, it's going to get more and more energetic as no doubt chances come, or there are moments of passion that ignite the fans.
As the rain starts to come down here, I guess it's more emphasis on the Aldershot Town turnout as well, Rob. Over 1,000 here.
It's absolutely fantastic. It was sold out 3 or 4 days ago. I understand the game here was sold out. They must have had a reduced number because the crowd is lower than last year's. A couple of hundred lower. So I would imagine that's restrictions.
Yeah. Certainly there was an awareness of that, I think, restricting numbers in the KRE and all sorts of areas.
So long ball forward looking for Effiong. O'Connell is there to it. Not the best of headers, though, because Effiong, unmarked, now has two red and white shirts in front of him. He's inside the working box, has to go back to half field. McNerney just throws a leg at it. So too does Anderson. It'll fall to Partington, who slice pass will locate Glover. Woking have shirts back now. And in numbers, Glover cutting infield, looking for Amaluza. And Woking can see that back to Craig Ross. It's Amaluza once again causing the problems, Ian.
Amaluza and Effiong there when he was on the ball, but he had two or three players around him. But he, you know, working a little bit messy there, really not clearing their lines particularly well.
Amond and Daly going for the same ball, and Daly's done really well to locate Amond now. Amond charging forward into the Aldershot Town box. Amond with his back to goal, looking for support. First time ball from Daly is a good one, looking for Kellerman! Woking are 3-1 up now! And it's Jim Kellerman, a former shot, who puts them in front up to 3-1 now. Jim Kellerman has got the goal, his second of the season. Wonderful play from Amond and Daly over on that far side. And Kellerman met the Daly cross, tucked it beyond Ashby Hammond, and all of Aldershot's good work has gone amiss. Woking 2-1 up on half-time, now 3-1 up, Ian.
Yeah, Jim Kellerman's been immense all afternoon, and it's been that whole thing of your ex-players come back to haunt you. Ine Effiong did that to Woking, and now Jim Kellerman has done it to break Aldershot hearts, really, and that gives a slight buffer to Woking to be 3-1, but it will settle nerves a little bit. Another flare coming on there, which is stupid, a red one this time, but let's not take that away from the game. Let's watch the game, and it's good play there by Woking, and a well-worked goal. Great work by Daly.
What do you say? Kellerman, his passing in the two games has been atrocious, but his spirit has been incredible. And he right now is the difference in both games, because he just won't go away. He's a pest for you, against you.
Oh, the keeper's lost out here, and the keeper's lost it to Amond, who has an empty goal to tuck it in, and Amond's made it 4! Shocking goalkeeping from Luca Ashby-Hammond straight from the kickoff, and in a matter of seconds, this game is dead and buried. Woking 3, Aldershot 1, and then a few seconds later, Woking 4, Aldershot 1. It's Patrick Amond who's got himself on the score sheet. It's his fifth goal of the season. And what calamitous defending, Ian!
What was Ashby Hammond doing? He's a young goalkeeper, so they're often taught to bring the ball out and play it around. But you don't do that with a... Potteringham just nipped in, took the ball off him and ran through on goal. It was... Well, that was...
Ridiculous.
Bizarre. And what was a very tight game and a hard-fought game in a matter of a minute has been turned on its head. One with a very good goal and one with atrocious defending.
Rob, what do you say?
Well, I didn't see how the build-up because I was facing you and just commenting on the previous goal. All I can tell you, those in red and blue will feel like I do. Stunned and sick.
They certainly will. The ball straight from the kickoff. Back to the goalkeeper in usual style that Aldershot have kicked off in this game. One route back to the goalkeeper who delivers long, got the ball stuck underneath his feet. And Patrick Amon, who does not stop running, gets a result for his efforts, gets a reward, and gives Woking a 4-1 lead here. 3-1 into 4-1 in just a few seconds. And Aldershot need to find their feet here because they were all over the shop at the back. And here come Woking again. Kellerman looking for Brown. It's just too strong as Ashby Hammond gets a few jeers from the Woking crowd.
And I have to say this...
Stunning. Staggering, yeah. I should say.
I don't mean this in any way to sound patronising or harsh, but you feel for a young keeper in a big game like this who's only 21, which is very young for a keeper. And to do that sort of mistake in such a big game is really hard, really hard.
And a keeper that has been pretty solid this year. He's one of three Aldershot Town players to play every single game. He's on loan from Fulham, learning his trade. He's played all in the youth system at Fulham, under-18s, 23s. His season at Aldershot, you'd hate to think will be remembered by that mistake. It's a low drive from Vincent, straight at Craig Ross. And it's all Woking now, Ian.
Yeah, good work there from Vincent to make that opportunity. Yeah, it is tough with those mistakes. I mean, Joe McNerney last year at Solihull, he did a back pass which was woefully short, an even game. Suddenly Solihull had their heads up and went on to win. And he said he'd never done a mistake like that in his career. And
here's
sure
Brown.
Ashby Hammond won't do it again.
Here's Reece Brown trickling his way through again. Reece Brown looking for support with Amond. Goes back to Anderson, who loses out but wins it back after a lovely turn there from Anderson on his opposite number. And Woking starting to celebrate in style here with Ince's shot on it off the post. Just wide from Rowan Ince. They are dancing their way through the back line of the shots now, who just simply need to regroup.
They certainly do. Where do you go from 4-1 down with 34 minutes to go? I mean, yeah, technically this time, but it's the New Year's Day that Woking have dreamed about for a long time.
Yeah. McNerney seals it out for an Aldershot corner. A reminder, only twice have Woking beat Aldershot Town here in the 21st century. It's a horrific record which surely will be improved upon here this afternoon. It's Woking lead by 4-1 and we haven't reached the hour mark. This game
attracts drama. Like surely, please.
Of course not. It's an excellent corner, looking for Cordner. Efiong is there, but punched away by Ross. And will be shielded out of play by Phillips. Corner kick to be taken by Klass. Vincent's gone short, so too has Harfield. And here he is. Harfield, back to Vincent. It's a good ball towards the back post, but it's beyond everybody, as Cordner and Efiong were just looking at each other. It's a clearance from Cuthbert, but Aldershot continue to apply the pressure here. Glover onto Klass. Now Amaluza with a bit of space and time to turn. Lassiter shot nearly out of the stadium. Let's go to Eastleigh. Eastleigh Dorking, Chris Baldwin. The game flipped on its head. Looks a pretty even contest at the break with the scoreline at 2-1.
I think both teams have been a little bit taken by surprise by the happenings of the last few minutes. It's almost as if Woking a little bit sort of, how did we get here? It was so quick and so sudden, particularly the third goal, and has really turned this game on its head.
goal kick. You would have thought Aldershot will be reacting with a change in just a minute. Indeed, there are a couple of players stripped, I think. We'll get Rob's thoughts in just a second as the clearance has fallen from Amalusa back to
Amalusa's the player, Cuthbert. Mark, that's been getting
clearance by Ross. Thanks very much indeed, Chris. Sorry, Rob, to interrupt you.
Yeah, sorry, working on the attack.
Brown, who's shaping for the shot, had a couple of opportunities to give it a whack and sort of was put off with it, really, with red and white shirts flooding forward. In the end, it's safely over the crossbar. Goal kick, Rob.
Yeah, Amalusa had a bit of a sighter at the start of the second half, similar to his effort in the first. He struck it well, but, you know, it was always going over. And I was thinking to myself, you know, his finishing's usually better than this, and if he gets another chance, he'll probably bury it. And he's just had another chance on his left foot, and he's put it even higher and even wider. So he has been the outlet. He's had a bit of joy. He's had 3-4 half chances in the game, but his shooting's been way off.
Yeah, he has been the leading light in the Aldershot team, it must be said. But he has been replaced by Harry Paniatu. So Amalusa's afternoon is over. To say if his finishing had been better, the scoreline might be a bit straighter. But it's been all Woking in the second half, and shocking piece of goalkeeping from Ashby Hammond. You call it defending because he was so far out from his goal. And Amon stole it off him and tucked it into an empty net. Received by rapturous applause from the Woking fans behind the goal, and the Aldershot fans could barely look. Free kick with half an hour to play. It's the Woking fans singing away to our left and indeed our right. And the Aldershot fans look on and need their team to find another gear here, as the rain continues to come down here at the Lathwaite. Harfield with the throw. Ross McNeely trying to get his team going once again. They've done it before. Can they do it again? They do have a mountain to climb. Amond, poor touch. Hacked away by Harfield. Cuthbert's header is good. And it ricochets off O'Connell. Harfield with the first time clearance. Straight to Casey, who we've hardly mentioned in the second half. But it's a poor ball into Daly, just about beats Davis to it, and he's wrapped his foot around Davis to produce the low cross, dealt with by Phillips. And Casey wins it back at the second time of asking, feeds it on straight through to Reece Brown, trying to get through two yellow shirts. Brown's still going, and Harfield has to throw a leg at it to produce the corner for Woking. Every time Brown gets the ball, it looks as though he's going to cause trouble.
Yeah, he adds something different to the other strikers, really. He's so comfortable on the ball, can make things happen. And I think Daly there again, we saw his pace, which, it's very rare. He, as Rob was saying earlier, he's a very direct player. Mm. Not particularly tricky, but it's just pure pace. And yeah. It's as the game opens up, it gives him more space to work with.
One hand in the air from O'Connell. It's towards the near post. Flicked on by Amon. It's gone through everybody. And the keeper eventually gets two hands to it. McNerney was just inches away. That could have easily been five. But the goalkeeper makes amends, at least for a little bit, for his error.
Just a bit of irony, really, Mark, that with that gift wrap goal for Amon, he becomes the first player in the game to actually not be scoring against his own side.
Do you know, I really like that stat. That's very well thought of. Very good. And Amond, who struggled at the start of the season, four goals. As Paniatu hits one from range, and you just got the feeling that Craig Ross wasn't always comfortable there.
I think you got a feeling as well that Woking took their foot off the gas there. They were just a little bit casual. They weren't attacking the ball as it came in. And that just shows how in this game that can really come back to bite you. And so Woking need to really keep their focus. Mm.
Interesting to see Corey Jordan going down the touchline for a warm-up but not venturing too far down. I don't think he wants to give another gift to the Woking supporters if they spot who he is.
Yeah, I agree. That's
very, very good, good young centre-back, by the way. Just had one of those days.
One of those days. Brown just overran it a little bit, but Daly's there to support. He's already gone past two yellow shirts and nearly a third. Just wrestling with the ball as Ince helps him out. That's a nice cushion pass to find Casey. Now with Anderson, strong touch, locates Kellerman in a bit of space as O'Connell was already racing away, and Darren Self throws the bottle at the floor in frustration.
Yeah, it's terrible, isn't it? It's going really bad, Darren.
Ince finding Amond. O'Connell on the overlap, and here he is, the Peterborough Lone, who had a tough first half. Amond into Kellerman, lovely flip back to Woking's most recent goal scorer, and he sort of stuck out a toe, if you like, a real punt, and it was just wide. Goal kick.
Charlie O'Connell has actually done very well today after, you know, getting a yellow card in the first half. He's got Iniefiong directly against him, who's at least probably getting on for a foot taller and a few stones heavier, and very quick, and he's handled him pretty well.
Kellerman's header.
I don't think he's had him for too long. Evion's come out to the left side as Harry Paniarty's come on in the middle.
Amond seeking Brown. And gives it straight to Ashby Hammond. Sorry, Rob.
It's just a strange one to me. I know Amaluza's shooting's not been great, but he's been the one outlet for Aldershot. He's been the one that's most looked like scoring. Yep. Perhaps a question for you later with Ross McNeely. But in any case, it's Woking's day. Although not in this instance, the foul's been given to Aldershot on halfway.
Which McNerney doesn't really appeal too much. Darren Sowell yet to use any of his substitutes. That's probably one of been the leading lights in his management. He knows when to bring a sub on. And he gets the timing right, usually pretty perfectly. Speaking of perfect, what a wonderful touch from Effiong. Beyond O'Connell and indeed Kellerman. Lofting the ball towards the back post, which Glover didn't anticipate.
Oh.
And
Yeah,
he was hoping for the Casey touch there, but it will be a goal kick.
100%, right? Glover was trying to get on the end of it, didn't really follow through with it. Casey touched it behind for an obvious corner, and the referee didn't give it. Strange one, that. And the Aldershot Town supporters are so disheartened.
Yeah.
They didn't even appeal for it.
No. Yeah. It's just killed them off a little bit, Ian, that mistake straight from that kickoff.
I think it's sparked, we were saying earlier, it's sparked the Woking fans are relaxed a bit and feel they have the confidence to let their voices be heard. And yeah, Aldershot, I mean, we've all been there when our club goes behind like that, and it's not a nice place to be, really.
No. But Nerney, Anderson, acrobatic clearance as Cuthbert finds Ross. Go through some other scorelines in just a moment or two. Darren Searle still conducting his team from the dugout. Headed down from Amond. O'Connell seeking Amond again. Picked up by Partington, not the place to really do it. It's surrounded by three red and white shirts who eventually dispossess the Aldershot left back. Kellerman now. How's O'Connell there? Kellerman's still going. He's going to try and win the corner, is he? Or is he going to keep going? Kellerman is. Just as I say that, corner kick, Ian.
Clever play by Kellerman there. I mean, he was almost playing like he was a tricky winger there, which he obviously he isn't, but he won the corner more by just physical presence and perseverance. We were saying earlier Charlie Connell's played well. I think what should also be added is he's had Jim Kellerman in front of him.
Yeah.
And often when the ball's gone towards him, Kellerman's been there to pick up the pieces, and he's been immense today, Jim Kellerman.
Casey's corner, right towards the back post. There's a player down, it's Cuthbert. The header from McNerney was over anyway. So goal kick given. Not too many other games have had recent goals in. I guess the most notable, Oldham 1, Notts County 2. Let's get an update, though, from the Silver Lake. Eastleigh Dorkin, Chris Baldwin. Goal kick to be taken by Ashby Hammond. Woking are readying a change. Or is... rather, Woking is just going to warm up. So too is Loftus and Johnson. And here comes Harfield back to corner. Mond is waiting to come back on after a quick bit of attention. Got 25 minutes to play. Woking 4, Aldershot Town 1. There was a foul there on Paniatu, but Nerney was the man that was guilty. So it will be an Aldershot Town free kick halfway inside the Woking half. Aldershot playing from right to left as we look in the commentary box towards the Kingfield Road end, stacked with Woking fans, and Woking left to right. Thanks very much indeed, Chris. We have a free kick here to Aldershot Town, which will be taken by Harfield, and they've really got to gamble the numbers forward here, Rob.
Absolutely, they've got to go for it now. Try and get one back, make Woking a little bit nervy. But the second, third and fourth goals, all preventable.
Yeah. chipped into the penalty area. McNerney's header again, and Amond lashes it clear. Bit of spin on the ball to offset Vincent, who calmly finds class, plays the 1-2 as well. Offloading to Partington, who finds Ini Effiong, who's pulled out to the left touchline. Has got Harfield on the overlap. Effiong in field, just too strong for class. A simple ball as Kellerman's gone down off the ball. Play still goes on now with Vincent onto Harfield. Low ball into the box, looking for Effiong. Just bounces off his shin and straight through to Craig Ross. Now Kellerman will be able to get to some attention.
Don't know what happened there.
Off the ball with Effiong, but I didn't see much. As we are going to see some woken changes. Looks as though Jack Rowles is readying himself to come on as the shirt comes off and the board is ready to come on. So what have we made then of the second half performance, Ian, of Woken? It's quite hard to say, really. I mean, the scoreline reads 4-1, but that third and fourth goal, as Rob alluded to, so preventable for the visitors.
It has been. I think they've also upped the energy level, I think, and the pace. I think possibly towards the end of the first half, they just sort of lost the momentum a little bit, came out very fast in the second half and have kept it going, and in both halves got a reward for that higher energy and pace and so on. And I think Amond has been superb this second half. He's really stood out, leading the line. He's such a talisman for the team, particularly for the younger players. To, you know, when you've got players like Scott Cuthbert and Podrig Amond as a young player, you can't take your foot off the gas because they will soon let you know. And Jim Kellerman there looks like he's picked up an injury and coming off.
Yep.
I've got to give him the man of the match over the two matches, Jim Kellerman. If one player epitomises just how much extra you can get in end product for sheer heart and determination, and it breaks my heart to say it, but Jim Kellerman.
Yep. Yeah, he's been excellent. He covers every blade of grass, doesn't he? He's got himself on the score sheet as well against his former side. And Rob leading the plaudits for Jim Kellerman, who has been excellent in that midfield.
And it's funny, really, how careers go. I interviewed Jim Kellerman for the programme earlier this season, and he had a rough time of it in football just a few years ago. Lost his way, ended up with injuries, picked up by Kidderminster, his hometown. And then I think just a connection with the Chesterfield manager that got him an opening there and just began to rebuild. And he's really enjoying his football again, which I think... And a question I asked him, you know, what would be your ambition in football? He said, oh, when I was younger, it'd be to earn £3 million and own a Lamborghini. He said, now I just want to be part of making a story and making a story with a football club and that people will remember forever.
Here's Brown making his way into the Aldershot penalty area, looking for Loftus at the back post, dealt with by Harfield, probably just a few yards away from the goal line. And the ball is cleared, which Cuthbert is onto. And he locates Craig Ross, who opts to take a touch. So Kellerman off, Loftus on. Loftus being dragged away by Harfield. They're both at it here. But eventually, Aldershot win the numbers game. And there's Int once again. He's been excellent in this second half. Another really good tackle from Anderson as well. It's a throw to Aldershot, which Darren Sowell wanted, didn't get. Harfield will take. Down the line, looking for Effiong. He was just caught by Loftus. The referee didn't see anything untoward, but Effiong remains down. Amond stabbed away by Cordner to Vincent. Effiong is back to his feet, although hoppling somewhat drastically. So you can run that off. Partington locating Effiong, who probably didn't really want it, but it's an excellent touch by the number 9 for Aldershot. But you can see straight away how he hopples away, and we will require a new ball for an Aldershot throw.
Yeah, a little bit of a knock he got there. I think it was Loftus he was in the challenge with, and I think it's one of those, you know, little painful ones that just catch you and take. He'll run it off, though.
Yeah, and here he is again. Feeds it back to Harfield. One touch. Finds Cordner. Maurice Brown challenging him for the ball. Cordner finds Glover, who slips. Stolen off him by Casey. Casey, with two yellow shirts in front of him, has somehow trickled it through to Anderson. Ball touch went flying in there, and Anderson could be in a spot of bother.
That might be a red.
It's a red card. Two of the last three games between Woking and Aldershot have seen red, and Anderson is off for an out-of-control tackle on the Aldershot midfielder. Couldn't see who, might have been Vincent. But the one blemish on the afternoon, if there was to be no more, is that Woking are down to 10, just as they were on Boxing Day. They will play now the end of this game, the last 16 minutes with just 10 men. Right decision, Ian Nicholson?
Hard to see from where
it's
we are.
It's a hard view, really,
I think
it?
The referee was very close. I don't think it was a malicious tackle. It wasn't. He wasn't flying in studs up, but he went in, caught the man, probably caught the top of the ball and then threw onto the man. And the referee's much closer than we are, so you have to say, you know, you have to go with the referee's decision on that. You just know that Jermaine Anderson's not that sort of player. And but it's... It will lift Aldershot a bit. Obviously, playing against 10 men, Woking will need to reorganise.
It's a lifeline for Aldershot, but they waste the resulting free kick out for a goal kick, which Craig Ross will take. Right decision for you, Rob? Again, it's a hard angle, really, isn't it?
It's difficult to tell, but my gut reaction as soon as he made it was that might be a red, so I was thinking in my head it might be red. Yep. A little bit mistimed, a little bit out of control.
I think out of control is the main element, really, isn't it?
I didn't sniff any intent with it, but he's got it wrong. And I didn't see too many complaints from Jermaine Anderson either.
Yeah. No, he shrugged his shoulders as he came off, you know. Reece Brown getting a bit of a tactical change here, taking off Reece Brown and probably putting on a more defensive player, I would imagine. It looks like Jack Rowles is going to come on.
Yeah, just to restore some solidarity about that midfield. But three goals for Reece Brown in the two games, Ian. He's loving life at Woking at the minute.
He is a very bubbly, positive character. And, you know, he also did very well at Wealdstone. And we were asking earlier, you know, how a player of his quality, again, with no disrespect, but playing part-time with Wealdstone, and you suddenly see, you know, you look at it.
Bless you.
Excuse me. But you know, you look at it, and one way or the other, he will play higher, I'm sure.
Yeah. Throw into Aldershot. Quarter of an hour left to play. They are going to make their second change when the ball goes out next time around. But Brown off and Rowles on. It's Rowles, Anderson, like Rowles and Ince rather in midfield, the two. Whilst Amond will just chase further afield. Daly and Lofthouse on the flanks, but they are tucking in. You can see how solid that four is. But can Aldershot unpick their two lines? Not with a pass like that. Goal kick.
I think that sort of play is just playing into Woking's hands, really. Two banks of four players and just keeping it compact, keeping it tight. Can't see who the player at the outlet is. If anyone, it would probably end up being Daly, who'd be the out ball. But while we've got a substitution going, I need to mention Dan and Lindsay Jesperson, who are listening in, with their son Arlo, who's in his Woking shirt, and he's also my grandson. So I said I'd give him a mention.
Excellent.
So he's only just over one. So he's hi Arlo, but he won't have a clue what's going on. But Dan and Lindsay are Woking fans.
Clearance from Ross, headed away by Class as the substitute who's just come on, Odie Alpha, has replaced Frank Vincent, nearly cut through the two central defenders of Woking.
It's a 4-3-3 now for Aldershot, although you'd expect Davies and Harfield to get well forward against 10 men. Glover's one of the three midfielders. Alpha has joined.
Loose ball, though, from
Effingham and Paniatu in attack.
Loose ball from Class, which Daly is onto. He's got Rowles to his left, but Daly just keeps on going. Daly, good challenge from corner, good defending from the Aldershot number five. Kept his eye on the ball. Corner kick to Woking.
Yeah, he's been solid for Aldershot, to be fair, all season and in these two games as well. But collectively, they haven't played well enough. And 4-1 probably flatters Woking in terms of the pure performances. But if you're going to make mistakes like they've made, if you're going to give the ball away like you give it away, then fair play to Woking for punishing them.
Corner kick to be taken by Josh Casey. We are going to see Elva Fontaine for Aldershot very shortly. Marcel Elva Fontaine, as the corner is whipped in, right underneath the goalkeeper. It falls to Amond. Left footed strike! Oh, and it's just wide. There was a nick through from an Aldershot Town defender. So it will be another corner. But Amond hit that with some real venom there.
Yeah. And Woking fans just waiting for that nick to bulge, wasn't
yeah.
it? And it didn't. It went just wide. But well done by Podrig Amond there.
We'll flash through some other scorelines shortly as we approach the final 10 minutes here at the Lathwaite Community Stadium. Lofthouse has gone short. Eventually receives the ball. Here he is, Kyron Lofthouse, infield on Paniar 2. And he can't retrieve the ball anyway. To a waste. Goal kick elsewhere. Bromley 0, Southend United 0. Still goalless there. Chesterfield 3, Scunthorpe 1. FC Halifax Town 0, Altrincham 1. Still goalless between Maidenhead and Wilston. Oldham 2, Notts County 2. And Yeovil will take the lead against Torquay. The only other game we haven't highlighted is the one down at the Silver Lake Stadium. It's Eastleigh against Dorking. Is it still 4-0? Chris Baldwin. Goal kick. Phillips rolls it straight back to Ashby Hammond. And a left-footed clearance. Not really with much distance. It's fallen straight to Daly. And Jack Rolls with that clean red and white shirt finds Ince. Daly gives it back to him. Cut between the lines is Amon. They're finding good space, Woking, even still with the 10 men. Ince, look at Amon now. Back to goal. Finds Ince once more. It's a long, searching pull for Lofthouse. But he's on the end of it. And he's up against his opposite number, Archie Davis. Outnumbered in the end. And cleared away by Elba Fontaine, who has just come on. And has found the pacey Odie Alpha at the other end. Effiong making his way into the penalty area. Still going as Alpha finds Elba Fontaine. Good tackle from Ince. And eventually is rewarded with a free kick. We've got pace, the boys that
great
have come
break.
On, Rob.
Yeah, great break.
McNerney's just been superb. I know he's come off a little bit worse physically in that one. But he's done the job again. And McNerney and Cuthbert. Superb over the two games.
Mm.
A brick wall for Woking.
And of course, Luke Wilkinson's been missing for a little while. That Joe McNerney had to come into the team. Many Woking fans thought about his form last year. Would that be a worry? He has been solid the last couple of months.
He came in and actually, if we remember, in his first game, Dorking, I think, he
yep.
gave away a penalty, which was a slightly debatable one, but he gave away a penalty in the first 10 minutes and everyone thought, oh no, you know. But since then, Joe McNerney's been absolutely faultless, really. Uncompromising. You know, talking to people who know him, they said he's the sort of player, the more he plays, the better he gets. He just needs to get in the groove. And last season, he never really got that opportunity. Mm. It just never worked for him, really. Yeah. And there were a lot of errors and so on. But this year, I think he's been great.
Just a bit of housekeeping. Craig Ross booked for time wasting before the free kick there. As Phillips doesn't really know where the ball was, eventually does Paniartu,
and the referee's hit his average of 6 cards per game, but it's his first red he's shown.
Here's Effiong, yellow shirts flocking to his right. Effiong still going, met with O'Connell, who's half the height and size of any Effiong. We know the battering ram that he can be. Has won his side a throw, which Paniartu is onto. Amond won the ball as Paniartu scrambles to get to his feet. Lofthouse puts it out of play anyway. Aldershot Town throw. What's happening here? Lofthouse and Paniartu off the ball. The referee indicating that this will be added on. I didn't really have the best of view with a bit of construction in the way. But the referee just talking to both Kyron and Harry. Aldershot Town throw inside the last 10 minutes. 7 to go. Half field.
If the first half's anything go by, it'll be 30 minutes out of time.
Yeah. It's good clearance by O'Connell. And Amond onto this. Corner is there. And Corner comes across and was just caught by Amond there, I thought. I thought he was fouled, but no, said the linesman, who was a yard away.
To
and
be
the
fair,
referee indicates a throw.
Yeah, we can't quite see where all the legs over the dugout there. So, but yeah, it looked from here, didn't it?
Looked like a foul, yeah. O'Connell with the throw.
I think the really disappointing thing, Mark, is that you wouldn't know Woking have got 10 men. Aldershot should
yeah.
be dominating the game now.
Yeah, absolutely.
Pressing and asking the question and nicking one back and making things interesting, but they don't even look like scoring. That's telling it like it is, I'm afraid.
Lofthouse finds Ince. Daly shaping for the shot, looking for the curling effort towards the far post. Just didn't really have the bend that he wanted. And we'll go out for a goal kick. Listening out for the man of the match. We've gone with James Daly, Ian. What do you think?
He's been good. No, he's been very good. I mean, I think Kellerman, we had a good shout with Kellerman. Daly's been great. And obviously, Reece Brown with
Reece
two
Brown
goals.
Reece Brown for me.
Yeah, I was going to say, a scorer of two goals today, one on Boxing Day.
Reece
against
Brown.
His old side, yeah, Reece Brown.
Not. Absolute class for me. But listen, that's the sponsor's choice. That's what they pay the money to get the opportunity to do. And that's how they've seen it. And he certainly didn't have a bad game.
I was going to say, he still had a good game.
Yeah.
I'll set up the third goal. Of course, with that excellent ball into Kellerman. And there he is, flying into the header, which has gone straight into the path of Padraig Amond. Red and white shirts flying in towards the back post. Davis, corner, cleans their lines. The goalkeeper couldn't pick it up, so he stayed away, but corner was on hand to sweep up. Oh, Casey, nice turn. Didn't come away with the ball, though. Aberfontaine lets it go to Partington. Here's Paniatu, central, chased by Casey. Paniatu's got a bit of space to operate here. Aberfontaine. Back to Partington. Partington from right to left. Mon couldn't get his head to it. Harfield did. Glover. Back to Iniefeong. Looking for Paniatu, who was between the central defenders again. The ball wasn't right. Phillips. Casey. To Daly. Off goes Daly once again. Doesn't need any second reminder. He might as well just go on his own. And here he goes. Caught, though, by Partington. And it will be a yellow card to the Aldershot Town captain. I think Rob makes a very good point, Ian, that it just doesn't look as though Woking are playing with 10 men out there.
No, I think the first two or three minutes, you know, Aldershot had a, you know, they got a bit more on the ball and were causing a little bit of threat. But certainly the last five or six has been very comfortable Woking, and to be honest, if any team's looking likely to get another goal, it would be Woking.
The man of the match, James Daly, given to him by the sponsors behind the goal, will be soaking up the applause here as he is being replaced in Woking's third and final change. James Daly, who is struggling for goals of late, certainly knows how to set one up. You cannot say anything bad about his work ethic, his fitness, his ability. And another top performance today from Woking's number eight. Jake Vokins comes on.
And I'll let Rob talk about the Aldershot team, but you can look at this Woking team, and we talked about man of the match, but I don't think you can look at any player who's had a bad game.
Yeah.
They've all done what they do, and it's a very established way of playing now. And they've all done their job. There are mistakes in there, obviously, but you know, things that don't go well. I thought Ince was quite quiet first half, but he's been immense the last 10 or 15 minutes. So, you know, it's all the players have done their bit.
Yeah, just got a bit of a halt in play here with a third flare on the pitch. It's right over by the corner flag of Woking's goal. And I think they're just waiting a few moments for it to die out. As Daly grabs his jacket. It's certainly cooled down a little bit in temperature. Coats are on. Woking looking to see off this game and see off Aldershot Town and what will be a memorable double for them. They've only ever done it once before. Way back in, I'll say way back, 2015-16. The Boxing Day, New Year's Day double. It's been all Aldershot pretty much since then, but it's not been their Christmas and New Year. The results do reflect the table for once, but for Aldershot it will be back to the drawing board. It's been a good couple of weeks for Ross McNeely, bar the festive season, and for Woking in 2023 it will all be about kicking on into the playoffs, where they currently sit fourth, and where will they end up? The free kick's still not been taken. Jack Rolls is, for some reason, going for goal from, goodness me, 40-odd yards out. And give him 100 attempts, I don't think that would have gone in. Goal kick anyway, Ian.
Yeah, I'm just looking at Darren Sarr. I don't think he was too impressed with that, if I'm honest.
No. I can't imagine he will be. As the ball is straight back with Partington. Here he is again, thrashing the ball up the pitch. Casey is there, and hoofs it straight into the Aldershot end, of which five, six, seven of their supporters are heading for an early exit.
A lot more than that.
I was going to say indeed more from the stand as well. It's but where do Aldershot go from here, Rob?
Home to Notts County, unfortunately. Home to top of the league, but they have a very good record. I think they've won the last three seasons at home to Notts County, and that's the kind of response they're going to need to find. The natives, the supporters, the Red and Blue Army are not going to be happy with this. Yeah, there are some. I'm not one of them that doesn't worry about anything else as long as they get the 6 points in this game. That's a silly attitude, really. It's about what you do over the whole season. And overall, I'd take, as much as I don't want to, losing both of these games if they can find their form again and push their way up the table and finish in a healthy mid-table. But if they're not careful at the moment, they could find themselves slipping back to danger again. It's certainly not done.
There's a bit of a buffer, isn't there? They've got a five-point buffer, I think, down to Oldham.
With a couple of games in hand, as Rob was saying earlier.
Yeah. So as Rob said earlier in the...
Oh, and they've been caught out. Vokins is going himself. He wants it on his left foot. And he can't quite wriggle it back. Loftus was there as well. Vokins will not give up. And there's Rowan Ince with yet another stunning tackle. Sorry, Ian.
Yeah,
six more minutes added on.
We saw earlier in the season, Aldershot had a purple patch and showed that there's a lot of quality in the squad, possibly a lot of inexperience as well. But it's, I really can't see, as a non-Aldershot fan, I can't see Aldershot really getting caught up in the bottom four.
You've got to think that there are definitely four worse teams than Aldershot. You look at the two that came down, Scunthorpe and Oldham, Torquay really struggling. I know Aldershot had that terrible day at Playmore. Gateshead, Maidstone, you get the sense that they'll be okay, don't you?
Creditable point for Oldham. They've held Notts County 2-2.
Rolls running the ball back on Paniatu. Ince gives it back to Wokens, number 18. Now to O'Connell, who's still charging forward down this right. And a good tackle from an Aldershot defender.
Great energy and work rate there by Ince in particular and O'Connell, and really not allowing any glimmer of hope really for Aldershot to get back into this game as we're now in added time.
Throw in to be taken by Woken's number 15 on his first start for Woken. A difficult spell in the first half, he's really come to life in the second, as have Darren Soule's other 10 players. There were 6 minutes added on. We've only played one of those, so still a little bit of time here. Will Woken add to the portfolio of goals here this afternoon, or Aldershot find a consolation, or will it stay as it is? McNerney hammers it away. It's actually a really good ball to Amond. Flag stays down. Will they head to the corner flag? No. Back to Ince. Here's Vokins on the turn. He'll want to add his name to the list of scorers here this afternoon. Amond, low drive, looking for Loftus, offloaded to Rolls. Is anyone going to go for goal? No, in the end. Just too strong for Amond as Ashby Hammond locates over to that far side, Archie Davis. And here he is again. Alpha has come short. Paniatu to his left, or Elva Fontaine to his right. Here he is, Elva Fontaine. Paniatu, Aldershot happy just to keep the ball here. Alpha away from one. Lovely couple of step overs, fouled by Loftus. Will be a free kick to Aldershot Town. We will check back in, of course, with EC Dorkin in the not-too-distant future. But last few minutes here, Rob, another chance from a set piece.
Yeah, anything Aldershot get now will be too little, too late. Credit to Woking, very solid over the two games. Gift-wrap goals, unfortunately, that will nag Aldershot. But see if they can get some late consolation.
Yep, they've got a free kick here, of which they have nine yellow shirts in the box. Curled in, though, looking for Phillips off the crossbar. Not too sure if Ross got a touch. Here's Effiong finding his left foot. Slices the effort. He's still going, meanwhile. And Glover goes all the way back out to Davis. Floating a ball towards the back post beyond Effiong. Harfield is there, though. Low drive across the face of goal. And Glover puts it wide. Off the crossbar. Good opportunity.
Yeah, very good opportunity. You know, Aldershot's best opportunity of the second half, really. And as Rob said, too little, too late. And, you know, in the end, the Woking faithful gathered around the fence now behind that goal, just waiting for the final whistle to blow to celebrate.
Yeah, good effort from Phillips, but yeah, coming back off the bar, kind of fitting with the day for Aldershot. Not their day.
Not their day. It's very rare to say that when it comes to this matchup. Corner, strokes it back to Luca Ashby Hammond, who we want to forget about today as soon as possible. Ince with the header, rolls with time to bring it under control, and it's a wayward pass to Vokins, who may win it back himself. Elba Fontaine onto Alpha, who's shown some real pace and energy since coming on, and here he is. Alpha going alone, and guess who's there? Joe McNerney. Alpha once more, shrugging off Casey. Still going, Alpha. Needs a bit of support. Left-footed drive, hits the side netting, and not too sure what the ref has brought it back for here. It's a yellow card to
a Woking player.
To Rolls?
Rolls,
or Ince?
I think. Rolls, Jack Rolls.
Sure, what happened there, Ian?
No idea. Must have caught Alpha's limping a bit, so I think he must have caught Alpha. Alpha's looked very
lively since he
came on. I don't know. Is there a reason he hasn't started? Does he come on as more an impact sub?
He's been ill over Christmas. He right. was playing and then was ill just before the Boxing Day game.
Right.
Well, he's looked sharp, as I say. He's dazzled through the working back line on a couple of occasions. And on another day, may have provided a real difference here. Here's Elba Fontaine, one of the other substitutes. Partington. Glover. Effiong, who knows what it's like to be on the wrong side of this fixture. Harfield. Glover. Woking fans up against the barriers, ready to celebrate, but they can't celebrate yet. Elba Fontaine to Paniartu. Ross saved it anyway. Flags up.
It was a good ball, actually, from Glover,
yeah,
to give
him
credit.
There it is. The full-time whistle was blown. Derby Day belongs to Woking for once. Boxing Day win, New Year's Day win. They've done the double over Aldershot Town for just the second time in the 21st century against Aldershot. 4-1 they've won here. Two goals from Reece Brown. Jim Kellerman's header, a shocking goalkeeping error from Luca Ashby Hammond, of which Amon tapped into an empty net. Four goals for Woking. Ini Effiong made things interesting at 1-1, 5 minutes from half time. But the day belongs to Darren Searle. The day belongs to Woking and the red and white cards. Their supporters will enjoy this for a long time. The Aldershot Town fans head for the exits. Another day for them. On a day that usually belongs to Aldershot, it's Woking's turn. They've won here by 4-1. Ian Nicholson.
Well, yeah, it's been a long time coming, and as a Woking fan, I can remember Jefferson Louis getting substituted at Aldershot. I can remember Scott Reynolds scoring a hatful of goals. I can remember Gallagher's last-minute goal. I can remember last season, it was a late goal that gave Aldershot the points, and it just seemed as though that was always the script, however good Woking were. And this season, they've made their ascendancy in the table count in the two big games. So they'll be very pleased, they'll be very satisfied. Delight, maybe more relief, actually, if I'm honest, just to get the monkey off your back and to say, right, that's now gone, now on with the season. So from a Woking perspective, Woking fans will be jubilant. Great Christmas period. It's now on for the rest of the season.
Deserving winners, it must be said. Rob, will come to you for Aldershot, of course, as you've mentioned, gift wrapped with a third goal, and particularly, of course, the fourth. Another day for them.
Yeah, full credit to Woking. 6 points over the both games. They've been the better side overall. Ironically, they've not had to play that well to win today.
Yeah.
They've got the job done very thoroughly, very professionally. They've accepted the gifts that they've been given. Full credit to Woking. I hope they go on and do well in the rest of the season. They're certainly right in the playoff mix. And for Aldershot, a lot of work to do. And a tough period for new manager Ross McNeely to ride out. But the best way that they can do that is to bounce back at home to Notts County next week.
Rob, thanks so much for your coverage today. Ian as well. Happy New Year to both of you.
Thanks, Mark.
It's a good day for Woking. They stay in fourth, but 12 points back to eighth place now. Bromley at eighth with 34. Woking comfortably in the playoffs. Have you heard that before? They start 2023 in the best way possible. They've beaten Aldershot Town by 4-1. Andrew Rayburn. Live or not? Yeah, great.
First of all, and
Sophia. I'm going to go run down and try and obviously get them up. Oh, I think Ross is here now, actually. Oh, he's here now. Okay, I will do. Thank you.
Testing, testing. When you can, Sophia.
Won't keep you too long, okay?
Second?
I won't keep you too long, okay?
Yeah, all good, mate.
Are we live?
We'll be live.
I certainly do, Andrew. Thanks very much indeed. Ross McNeely is standing alongside me after defeat here at the Lathwaite Community Stadium. Woking 4, Aldershot Town 1. Ross, what are your initial thoughts after the defeat here today?
Embarrassed. Like, I think, like, for the fans in particular, like, obviously losing to your rivals isn't good, but losing to them in that manner isn't the best. And we have to be responsible and take some accountability. And at times in the pitch, certainly second half, it didn't look like that. Lots of work to do.
The defensive mistakes that have really cost your side today.
Well, they've cost us in both games, but I think that's very clear and very evident to see. We went for the three games not conceding, and that seems like a million miles away. So, like I said, a lot of work to do. Like that has to be a wake up call, and we've had a few home truths in the dressing room, but ultimately, like, it always falls on my head and falls on my staff's head. So, like, we've got to be better, and we'll get to work and try and be better. Just can't be better than that. That's not acceptable.
Speaking on the first half, I thought despite going down, you handled the pressure quite well and got yourself level. And I think at 1-1 at half time, maybe would have been a fair result.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, obviously, like again, but on the other side of that, we have an opportunity going at 1-1 and we don't deal with it, and we come at 2-1 down, and certainly things I've not seen so much of in my time here, but that certainly were in before. So, like, that again, we've got to be better than that moments. Like, you get into half time at 1-1, it's a different conversation, and we come in at 2-1 down, and then we have a good chat at half time, and then we go out and everything's out the window, really, with the two mistakes. So, like I said, it's we've got a lot of growing up to do, and a lot of responsibility and accountability for it, and that falls on me as well. So, like, yeah.
Bar the mistakes, what was missing out there today?
What was missing? I mean, you said we were good first half, but like, we're not good for 90 minutes, and you got to be good for 90 minutes, and. I don't know what it is with this group. Like I said, we were excellent against Southend and Gateshead, and three games down the line, like, here we are, and against our local rivals, where, like, ultimately you shouldn't have to be motivated or you shouldn't have to be focused and switched on, and we got caught.
Where do you go from here? I'm sure the fans tonight will be upset and hurt. Of course, you turn out very quickly with Notts County at home. Where does the club go from here? What have you said to your players?
Obviously, yeah, we've got Notts County, but the fans will be upset, and rightly so, by the way. Like, so, I don't think they should not be, and they'll be fuming as well, like I am. Where do we go? We've got to dust ourselves off. We've got to go again against the best team in the league in 7 days' time, and that's going to be hard, and that's going to be a challenge. And I'd always expect us to sort of like come back and bounce back. We have in the past under me, so I don't doubt that we will do it. But like I said, it has to be a wake up call, this, because like I've got people. I think James was saying to me when I came off there, he was like, "Yeah, it happens," and I'm like, "Yeah, but not against these." Like, that can't happen. Like, and that, like, that's turned on its head from what it used to be. And I was very clear before, like, these two results won't define our season, but like, you have to pick players up from these results, and that's going to be it's going to be hard to do.
It's still early days with you in charge. Are you happy with the squad you have? Are you hoping to maybe add one or two names in 2023?
Yeah, I mean, we need to. You're looking at the subs that we made and the people we've got to impact the game, and like we're short in some areas. We're short in areas, and we're short central at the centre of the pitch, and we need to strengthen that area as well. And I've been very clear with that. But it is what it is. We are where we are, and we're trying to bring people in and trying to move people around and shuffle the pack. But like, that's easier said than done, and hopefully we can get something done in and around January. But like, I'm always confident that we'll bounce back, and I'm always confident we'll do well. But like, yeah, we'll go from here.
Ross, thanks for your time.
Thank you very much. Cheers.